Man, y'all got quiet quick.
Afraid the recorder kick on.
Okay, red light's
okay,
on.
Okay, the light is on. Okay, good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't, have not been here regularly, we have to wait until the recorder comes on. So we're live now. But good morning, welcome to this, I guess, our budget workshop. This can be interesting and boring, and we will get started right off the top with Bob Wedgeworth, EOC.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm not used to making a presentation on my budget in front of such a great crowd, but I'm glad everybody's I hope I'm glad everybody's here. I don't know yet.
But the good thing about it is they're at your back.
Yeah, I hope that's a good thing. All right, I'm going to start with my letter, and then we'll go through all of them. I guess we're going to start with fire and then progress through.
That's probably about it. Sounds good, because most of them, I think, are firefighters, I believe.
I will say that Brian is gone. He's got a family issue, so I'll cover vector control. That should take, I'm guessing, probably about a minute or so to cover vector control, unless y'all got a lot of questions on that. But I'll start with my initial letter, and this pretty much the letter I wrote y'all addresses all the emergency services, fire, EOC, and the 911. With the desire to increase emergency services for Rankin County by incumbents and candidates and to provide efficiencies, we must examine the opportunities to improve by investing in Rankin County emergency services. The reliance to access emergency services continues to increase, with a growth rate of 25% in some areas, according to the U.S. Census report. We must be proactive in funding emergency services to keep pace with the rising demand. The increase in call volume countywide is indisputable. The ability to field first responders during certain times has degraded to dangerous levels. The staffing of all segments of emergency operations must be increased to provide desired results of improving services to county, 911, EOC, fire, and additional staffing, and the current funding of the staff already in place should meet or exceed the local professional averages. Training requirements have increased. The squeeze placed on family lives and the burdens of endless fundraising, less flexible employers, have all contributed to the decrease in numbers of our volunteer ranks. 11% is the nationwide average since 1987. Incentives for recruitment and retention of volunteers must be explored. Rankin County Emergency Services must keep pace to provide the public demand with expert staff, not only in field services, but to protect the current and future county investments. A mixture of funding should be evaluated. As previously recommended, 3 mills earmarked for emergency services would produce approximately $4.2 million per year. Other fees should be examined. No fees or taxes are desirable without an increase in service or cost savings to the residents and business owners. As we all recently reminded, citizens value the return of their investment for emergency services in Rankin County. So, like I said, in saying that, everything else is pretty much going to be in black and white. And I'm going to let Brett come up and talk to the specifics on the fire side. If y'all got any questions to me, of course, we'll be doing I'll get to the EOC and 911 if y'all need me to, or if you got any questions on the fire, we'll just let Brett come on up and get started on the fire side.
Okay. Good morning.
Morning, sir.
Good morning.
Did everybody get a copy of the budget request proposal? Okay.
Please, sir.
All right, some of the big items this year on the fire budget is the purchase of a new fire apparatus for Lake Harbor Fire Department. This will be to replace a 15-year-old engine at their station 2. to purchase a tanker for Monterey Volunteer Fire Department and also to purchase a tanker for Shell Road.
What item is, what line item is that, Brett? Okay, gotcha.
This one right here.
I got you.
This one, right.
Line 918?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. 918.
Okay.
Okay.
So really, you're looking at?
You see it?
Line 918.
Oh, got it.
Looking at an increase of about, what, 150? Somewhere around there from last year's?
Yes, sir. We were on the list last year as far as with forestry to get a tanker to replace the one at Monterey.
Mm-hmm.
We had that money set aside last year, like we did, you know, trying to do this year.
Right.
And we were unable to get one just because of the demands. We didn't get one in. So that was that money that we spent and bought the 103 radios with.
Right.
So that, you know, just.
So we were able to use that in lieu of for the radios.
Yes, sir.
Which we had to buy anyway. Okay.
Just going over, you know, the requests that I received from the, you know, from the fire departments, was the tankers and the fire trucks that I just mentioned. Also, Puckett is requesting that we help them build a new fire department. I believe, Marvin, you here? Y'all have already purchased the property, correct?
Yeah, the town.
Okay. And that is also on the explanation sheet.
Okay. What line item was that one on? I guess, let me.
It's going to be. Yes, ma'am. Okay.
So it's not on.
It's not on that one?
Yeah, I said that as a separate line item.
Okay, so that, what was the request on that?
200,000.
200?
And it depends what line item it goes. It depends on if it will be an allocation of funds to them or if we will construct it and it would be construction in progress. So it just depends on how we handle it as to where we go.
Marvin, does Puckett plan on putting any money into this too?
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, they've already, I guess they've already, is it, did they buy the, purchase the property or how did they get it?
They purchased the property and tried to, they just need some help with it.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So how old is that?
Well, is that going to be putting another truck in there too or?
No.
Just building a station?
Just building a station.
Another station to replace the existing or?
Right. The station they have is, I mean, it's an old, I mean, Marvin, when was that station built?
Oh, it was built way years ago.
I mean, it's, I mean, it's.
We've run out of room. We built up all the equipment where we need it, but we don't have any place, you know, to put it in that.
Right.
Okay. I think you're having to store a lot of it even offsite, aren't you, as far as up at.
Yeah.
Okay.
You don't have any kind of design or any type of. Yet of what you're talking about building.
Well, we've got some
preliminary, I think, don't you?
Yeah.
Because you had to come up with a dollar figure. I figure you had something to.
I think you scaled back a little bit too, haven't you? So.
Okay.
Okay. So this right here then doesn't reflect the 200. Okay.
On your miscellaneous sheet here,
yes, ma'am.
The fire, I did add it.
You did add it in that? Okay.
It's not on his sheet.
I got you. Okay,
I
good.
Did add it in.
Okay. So this could be, like you said, could be cash or in kind, basically, through however we work it out through all that. Okay. What kind of timeframe? I know it's in this fiscal year. When y'all looking at that, Marvin? I know as quick as possible, I'm sure, but.
Yeah, we're trying to work the land now and trying to get cover for all in and do some stuff to the prep part, but as soon as we get the bond, we can begin the work.
Okay. Would you be able to build it in this fiscal year? Is that what you're planning?
Yeah.
Okay.
We're shooting for this.
Okay.
You're talking about this coming fiscal year?
The 16th.
Yeah.
After October 1st, right?
Right.
Okay. Okay. What line item are we on the main, on your main?
We're not. Miscellaneous funds review, the one that says miscellaneous.
Yes.
Funds,
106. Okay. Oh, here it is. So does that reflect? Does that reflect in here also?
Yes, it does. If you look, and I added those in, if he sees why the budget looks high, is because I had to also finishing Walters and the reservoir. I had to bring extra money over into that because those won't be completed probably
right.
In September. We'll have the money to pay for that. So if you look over here at how much the budget would be increasing from the current year that we're in, would be about $375,000. Our revenue coming into this next year, which would include a transfer from the Grand Gulf funds of $790,000, is $2,076,125. So you can see that our output is $2,900,000. So we're about $900,000 short in revenue versus expenditures.
Right.
Did any of that grant money play into this?
The $70,000 for the round that we have, it is figured in the receipt side.
You know, it's really pitiful that, I guess, you know, I'm glad we get $70,000, but I wish we could get more than that. I guess that's based upon, it doesn't go very far.
I want to say something else. That's the kind of the premise of my letter. I mean, you know, we continually falling behind.
Right.
I mean, we're not gaining any ground, and you know the requests are going to keep coming, and you know it would be best if we could develop some kind of systematic long-term plan for, you know, when we got the districts broke out, you know, and some of them are overlapping into different supervisor districts, but you know I think it would just be better for all of us if we could, you know, look at some kind of long-term strategic plan that would get us, you know, show some type of development, you know, long-term. Because, you know, it impacts, you know, whoever's going to be, you know, up there, you know, 6 months from now is going to be fighting the same battle that you guys are fighting, you know, every year.
Right.
And it's, you know, until we get to where we can develop some kind of long-term strategy. And another thing that could possibly impact all of us here, you know, and everybody sitting back there, including our municipalities, is the possibility of a new insurance fire rating that's coming up. We don't know how to, you know, that could have a significant impact on everybody here. And, you know, it's just like the lady said the other day, you know, when those insurance rates go up, you know, $600-$700, you know, whoever's in those seats are going to be, you know, that's who's going to be catching the heat, you know. And that's just something, you know, it is what it is. I mean, it's a reality of, you know, with growth comes this. And if they change that, you know, rating, and the paid guys will tell you right now, it's going to have a significant impact on them just on training hours. I mean, their man hours are going to, I think, almost double, you know, on their requirements.
Huh.
We don't know how this new rating is going to impact us.
When is that supposed to hit, Brent?
It'll be sometime after legislative. Do you remember when this is supposed to go into effect, Mr. Deal?
The ISO stuff's in place now.
Yeah, they're starting to put it in.
Yeah, they've already started breaking some of the farms, some of it actually going down, some of it going up.
So we don't know, it may have a positive impact on some and a negative impact on others.
Did they change the way that they do the rating?
They changed up several of them. Like I said, we're talking about a whole nother day just to sit down with you guys and tell you how that's going to impact.
Do they recognize phone now?
I don't know if they recognize phone or not. Do you know, Mr. Bell, if they...
No.
Is phone helping us on the rating at all?
Under the ISO, they are looking at how ready the road is supposed to be.
Once again, depends on how the election comes out with the insurance commission. There's a lot of things, right now we're dealing with strictly theory. But, the one thing that we do know, the population's gone up, call volume's gone up. Whoever's sitting up there is going to be impacted with the request from, here on out, as long as we continue to grow. And, the need for us to develop some kind of systematic plan long-term, I may be oversimplifying it, but, like Brett and I were talking, we've already got plans for fire stations that we've paid for. They can, make modifications.
Wait, say that again.
We've got plans for fire stations we've paid for. We just, we're building the one at...
Walters.
Walters, right. We built the one, Monterey.
Right.
These are, places we can save money for, but we've got to put some type of systematic plan in place. Of course, each one can be altered, somewhat, but that's just...
Right.
Money that we can save. But, it should, like I said, on a long-term plan, incorporate other things. The Monterey station is a good example. It's a multifunctional building, that's good for the community. It's a vote precinct, a community center, fire station, all that. But like I said, it depends on what kind of long-term plan we're going to do.
All right. Under 918, some of the other things we're looking at doing is a annual service of all the air packs that we have. And the county bought JAWS equipment for the department. Some of them are, 10 to 12 years old. Start replacing those throughout the county again. Instead of buying all of them, the same year, over 2 years, buying four sets a year.
Is that, who we get to service those air packs? Is that local?
Yeah, it's going to be local.
Okay. And this is all the requests you got in?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
That's good. How does a jaw, what wears out on a jaw that has to make it replaced, be replaced rather than repaired? I'm just curious.
The hydraulic cylinders, the blade, stuff like that.
Yeah.
New cars now are being made with different materials, so the cutting force on the newer jaws is a whole lot stronger. So.
Okay.
How many times a year do you use the jaw?
Numerous.
100, 50, 200.
Depends on where that.
Yeah, depends on where.
I think it was Star one time had one that was so old that the liquid that was in it would eat a person's skin if it leaked out on them when I was first elected. Wasn't that right? And I thought, we're going to get you a new one.
On the jaws, we were talking to some of the municipal chiefs the other day, and it's having an impact on those guys too. And we were kind of reminiscing, like you were talking about. And another big issue now is when we have multiple departments responding to a call, and if you got a rescue coming with the jaws, you think your assumption is that everything's all right, but if you have a malfunction, now you're delayed again, waiting for another department to come. With a set of jaws.
Right.
So you know, and when that golden hour's ticking away, you know, it's not good for anybody.
No, they all need, I agree, they all need the...
What does the job cost?
Oh, I'm thinking, I didn't look at the press...
Four sets of them is around $70,000.
But you really can't put a value on them if it's what's gonna take to get you out of the vehicle, someone out, so really, no way to... I've seen them work, they're unreal.
Yes, and that's for a whole, you know, complete new set, that's with the, you know, the new pumps, high capacity pumps, rams, cutters, spreaders.
Let me ask you a question on the buildings on line item 540. Got $60,000 in there. Is that buildings for fire departments, or is that buildings here, the, where y'all are housed, or what is that, what does that entail?
That's gonna be repair on initial, I mean, like already built.
Fire stations?
Structures, right.
Okay.
I know there's some stations out there, the air conditioner gone out, different ones have had some flooding issues, some of them have had leaky roofs, different things happened, different buildings, you know, we just put that in there.
Okay.
General.
Does that cover, is that pretty well off?
It may not be a specific fire station.
Right. Several.
Different fire stations.
Right.
Of course, you never know when somebody's gonna drive through a building either.
Yeah, you got that right.
I would've lost money on that bet too. I rode out there all night, I was trying to drive through a fire station.
Yeah, you can scratch your head on that one for a while.
You know, I wasn't really anticipating that one either.
No.
Just glad nobody was there.
Yeah.
That's bad.
Yeah.
546 shows other repairs and maintenance jumped $7,000, what do you...
That's on all the fire trucks. Any county-owned fire truck, we pay for the maintenance.
Okay.
On those trucks, they need tires, we buy tires, I mean, if it's, I mean, whatever for those trucks.
So you followed your budget pretty good, and you've seen the needed increase on that?
Yeah, I'm getting close.
Okay. James, I think your hearing aid went off.
I didn't know whether I could play anything else.
No.
Brett said nah. You don't need a new fire station though, do you, James? Okay, thank you.
Brett, I mean, you got, that's just radio repairs, you're just budgeting for what you think, or...
Yeah, with...
We just bought a bunch of radios, I know.
And we'll have, you know, that service agreement for, I think they got like a one-year warranty on those. Some of the radios we're getting from the sheriff's department, since those are some older radios, we just kept that in there in case, you know, we had some problems, needed to buy some batteries or some screens were cracked or whatever.
Okay.
Consumable. What's this, 695, line item, other consumable supplies?
That's gonna be the totes of foam that we buy.
Okay.
And also the freight and shipping charges on 590, we went up on that. Because both those line items, I'm very close on.
Don't know how much I've raised. I don't think I have money for that.
Let's see.
No.
So Laura, you're looking at total increase, it looks like of $374,588, is that what we're looking at for fire? Okay. Right.
They were in last year's and I had to bring four in this year, plus the new. So all of this is basically new requests.
Okay. I'm sure we got some people back there want to say something. James?
The question was that, going back to the goal.
Yes.
I mean, I can give you.
Yes, sir.
That's kind of like the insurance.
Right.
You don't need it. You pay for it, but you don't need it. You don't use it, but if you got it.
Right. You hope you never have to use it.
Hope you never have to.
But you got them.
In the last few months, we have had to have a helicopter come in and pick up, work up the wreck that we made.
Right.
The dog, you know, we and I mean, mine are good, but the thing is, the point I'm trying to make that one time that you got to have them, they're worth $1 million.
Yep.
If you don't have to have them, or they, you get there that $1 million and it won't crank or it won't function, it ain't worth two cents. Now, y'all sitting up there, one sitting over here, what if it was your wife, your kids, or even yourself that had a bad wreck and had to be cut out? Whoever gets there, you expect that thing to work, right? In good order.
Mm-hmm.
With that being said, that's all I was going to say. They don't matter how much they cost.
Right. Got to have the equipment.
I think that was point was made when I said what I said. That was the exact point. You can't put a real value on it. Right. No, I mean, I think we recognize that. Everybody does. It's kind of like the things we do for the sheriff's departments. That one time you saved a deputy's life or something, you can't put a price on that, on the equipment that they have, you know.
Well, key in on something that was said earlier too about call one and the increase. When we're going from 25% increases every year to 53-54% call volume increase, that's a reflection of the population. Our population is going up, call volume is going up, more rare wear and tear on the trucks.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the way households run these days, makes it real hard. So when we talk about jobs and training, you know, within the county for equipment or trucks or whatever, they go a long way, especially when you're out there working on training. A lot of the rural areas, we've got a lot of people coming out trying to get their back. A lot of people coming out to the rural areas to retire, just to be honest with you. That's where a lot of that comes from. So, and I hope that you see, you know, we're trying to support what these guys are presenting to you as a united front, because at the end of the day, it affects every one of us here.
Right.
Directly, it affects every one of you and those constituents out in the county with the quality of service.
Well, it's like we said, I don't know how many times it's been said, volunteer fire departments, you can't put a price tag on. And we appreciate each and every one of you that, and of course, the municipalities too, for sure, but the volunteers, you know, 1-2 o'clock in the morning, you know, getting up from their bed or not being able to eat or whatever, you know, with their family. So very much appreciated.
Yes, sir.
How you coming along with your?
Ma'am?
And still go to work the next day.
How are you all as a whole departments, as far as keeping enough, I guess, recruits and new recruits or whatever? Because I know that is vital in keeping the fire ratings where they need to be. And
the national average, most volunteers, I think the average is like 4 to 5 years in actuality.
Mm-hmm.
So it's so fortunate that we have people that have been there 15 plus,
right,
20 plus years, those dedicated folks. But recruitment and retention is a constant challenge. It has been a challenge for years. A lot of folks thought after 9/11 that it was actually going to increase because more people want to get involved, but in actuality, it's hurt.
Well, that's the problem, even with the, I mean, for everybody. And I mean, all I have around me are, except in Richland, are volunteers. So I'm very sympathetic to everything and the needs. But with that, I mean, even with the finest equipment, you don't have the
personnel.
I mean, your fire ratings still drop. And that's what, it, as a whole affects the community. So what I hear the most about is, you know, all of a sudden they're talking about rating bureau maybe changing things now. Insurance have gone up from, if you got like go from an 8 to a 10, you're going to pretty much double your homeowner's insurance. So like I said, without, even with the finest equipment, that's what I don't know how we can, or how you or any of us can solve the problem. You know, you got young people that aren't interested in getting involved in that type of situation, and you just see it all over in the involvement, not just in the fire department's involvement in a lot of things. So I think that's something we need to work on as much as looking at how we're going to do a budget in a way. You know, I don't know the answer to that, and that's what I'm just putting it out there. Well, certainly. That's what I'm saying. It's just like your household. All goes back to funding. Yeah. Yeah.
But I mean, there's, several. I've talked to a lot of these guys. We, a lot of them have their work out, different plans and options, to work on. So, we've got some things that we think that may work out there. But
good.
We'll just have to see.
Yeah. Oh, I understand.
So, we've got trucks that are broke down and not functional. Right here, if we come in right now, we
could
lose rates.
Oh, I agree. But I mean, like I said, I just meant, you can have a brand new truck, but you don't have people to run it. Right. No, I think we do a pretty good job of keeping good equipment. And I've always said, our equipment in Rankin County is almost second to none. And the rotation, the way we try to do the trucks, and I don't know how we could better that, really. I mean, y'all do a good job of taking care of them, and but like you said, if you don't have a driver, it's not going to do you much good. So
how do you recruit your volunteers?
Ask.
Right.
Right. They, Rodney.
We're recruiting 24/7. That's basically.
Yeah. Right.
Well, they've also have community, functions and stuff like that for the community. Yeah. So that's where they pick up a couple people too. So.
Okay.
They're working hard to recruit. I can tell you that.
They are. The problem is, it's just not being able to get enough of them. I know you're always working. I don't imply that at all. It's just getting them to say yes and be, I guess,
say what, James?
Stay with you too.
No.
I know.
Volunteerism is hard. Paperback off a little?
Huh.
Hmm.
I can leave one and I got two standing at the door wanting to get on.
Right.
You know, with us filling out applications. And, but the younger ones, and most of them are transferring from other departments.
Right.
It's not, you know. And you get the young ones that, you know, want to get on with us. They come up, pay for it, pay them. It takes a stomach with being somebody else that's been in this a long time, a lot of time, to do what we do in a quote-unquote hard heart. You get these young kids coming along, and they're doing fine. First bad wreck they see with either of fatality or leg being cut off below the knee.
Right.
Yeah.
And I try to tell them when they come in, I said, everything ain't a bed of roses here, so you're going to see some gory stuff.
Right.
Oh, I can handle it. Yeah, they can handle it until they see it.
Right. Mr. Marvin, I think you've got something going pretty good. How's that going as far as the...
Well, I want to say one thing we've run into was just not having a good incentive out there. My deputy chief had talked with chiefs in other states.
Right.
Thinking maybe something we need to work on at a state level, because some states has like a retirement system set up for volunteers.
Huh.
And, you know, on a statewide, you know, view, they've got some things in order that kind of gives an incentive. At least you know you're going to
achieve something.
With, yeah. You know, it's just not... just all out there and open. But one thing too I wanted to put a plug in, we've lost a lot of good trained. I mean, it takes a lot of money to get somebody mm-hmm. trained at the level that they need to be. And we've lost a lot of good personnel before due to, like Chief Webb was talking about, due to things they've seen out there and mm-hmm. decided, no, this ain't for me. And that's one reason I'm glad that the Traumatic Incident Support Team is in operation. That we have seen some kind of pull from that, you know, burnout, and you know, was able to unload it so they could fill back up.
But, right.
You know, it's just it's just hard to keep the incentive out there.
Sure.
You know, and you just had to pull from all areas to try to give them what would help keep it rolling. You know. And, but I think maybe on a statewide level, we need to lobby and do some stuff.
That's a great idea. I think that is a, you know, that's where it would have to start. I think it's a great idea.
Yes, yes.
John Pope, he's starting to work on something like that, but it's exactly what you just said. We need to get with him and, you know, give him as much support as we can.
Exactly. We need some push behind that to make sure that's...
stand together and help him out.
Yeah, especially when it comes in. There's a lot. I think there's a lot of money left. And I'm not saying a lot of money, but I think that there is some help. Should be some from the state level, because we're not talking about just Rankin County. We're talking about all of the counties in the state. So I'm sure that the good thing about it is we're very fortunate, I believe, that what we do have. But other counties that I've talked to, they're lucky if they have anybody coming when they have a call. So you know, a lot of it's going to be from that state level where I think that could take a big burden off of us, but we need to get behind that. So, Bob, if you and Brett would touch base with the chiefs and stuff, and I think that get with the gentleman you were talking about that from the state level, whatever we need to do to get in there too to help, especially with legislature coming up. So,
well, is there anything in the budget regarding helping them recruit?
Well, like how?
I don't know.
I've got some.
It's just a question.
I may hurt some.
Well, it sounds like personnel is key.
It's what? Yes.
Key.
Personnel, oh, it is.
That's one of the things, you know, like I said, there's a ton of, you know, incentive programs out there across the state, you know, and, you know, one of the things that dawned on me the other day when I was standing here talking, listening to Dr. Hughes speak, you know, there's a, you know, perfect partner for an incentive for, you know, young firemen right there.
That's right.
You scratch my, our back, we scratch yours, you know, things like that. You know, some incentive to get these younger guys in, get them involved, you know, because I can tell you, you know, it's the double-edged sword Chief Cook's talking about. You've been there 15 years, you know, after you've been there 15 years, you know, those jaws get, you know, start getting a little heavy when you start toting them around. And if you don't have some younger guys that you can, and don't know what I'm talking about, if you ain't got some younger guys in that pipeline that's going to come in there and be helping you out, because it's, you know, you're working pretty hard when you go on fire. If you're not, you know, it, no good outcome's going to come of it.
Right.
So, you know, without those young guys in there, you know, it's just a matter of time before, you know, you start losing older people because, you know, they just can't function at that level anymore. It's a, you know, physical impossibility. Not for me, man.
You're hard. Yes,
ma'am. I know we're talking about volunteer-wise, but I wish y'all would take under consideration how many years of experience you have sitting in this room right now. They may be older. No offense, Mr. Bale. Love you to death. You know what I mean. But they're here. They're dedicated. They're always going to, well, in fact, they're not always going to be here. But the experience you have here will show you that somebody is going to be there. Always. And they're always backing each other up. Always. Whether it's municipality, whether it's volunteer, we're always helping each other. So regardless of if you have 10 people on your roster, if you have 30, we still need the equipment. Because
oh, yeah.
We're still going to be there. You're talking how many years? 3 years? How many years, Ms. Carr? Jackie? We are not going anywhere. We are going to be here.
You didn't ask 50.
50 years. I apologize, Mr.
But we're not talking about lack of equipment at all. I don't think that's even in the equation. We try to, like I said, we try to keep the most updated, best equipment we can. And we appreciate the ones of you all that have been able to get grants and help provide you, supply a lot of your needed equipment. We appreciate that. That's everybody working together. But no, and that's the thing. You are a dedicated bunch, but what I recognize, and it's been very clear in your conversations, is you don't have the young ones to replace you that will be that dedicated as you can train as you move on later. And so that's where we're back to finest equipment, but you got to have the operators with it. And you do, the backup is great, but what happens, as you know, in your fire ratings, if you don't have, you can't, the way they rate it, you can't just have a backup. You can't be rated because you got a good backup. You got to have enough men in that, in your department to man it, to sustain that rating.
But that's not the only thing that plays a part in it.
No.
Minor factor compared to what we have to maintain as a volunteer fire department.
Right.
With our rating.
Yeah. Like I said, I can't even count them how many we have, but in my district. Right. So, yeah. But Jackie.
Another avenue that we might explore, maybe a junior program. I'd say out of the last 8 to 10 recruits that I brought came in as juniors.
Yeah.
They are now rolling over, they're turning of age, we're getting approved for certain classes. And it's almost like we skipped a generation, the 20s and 30s.
Uh-huh. That's what I've noticed, yeah.
They don't have the time, or they don't wanna make the time, or whatever. But there's a lot of kids out there that want to do it and have no clue that they can even come to a board. I've got six guys that's going through certification right now, and out of those six guys, five of them come to a junior program.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and then the times I've visited the different, I always see you all and all the ones that I can at different times in our district, and that's what I see. And that's the reason I brought it up. And you're right, you skipped that. And, I think it has a lot to do with just people, so many aren't as dedicated or they're not influenced of the importance, because, you can't only get people to volunteer. You get a small group to volunteer to run a concession stand. You can't get numbers. It's going to be that little small group that does everything in a community. And I think the state legislation thing, I think that is a good start. But anyway, I'm glad y'all are here and voice your, we're all, I can tell we're all on the same page. It's just trying to make it work. Yeah.
The thing is, you got that one generation that don't know what that four-letter word is. You know what I'm talking about?
You singing to the choir. You preaching to the choir here, brother.
You got that one generation. Was probably more than one now. And my youngest was in that generation. You don't have a clue what word work is. There's a five-letter word that they don't know what it is either.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, and they won't ever, my oldest one works his tail off every day. Every day I can't keep up with it. Keep it good, but I can't stop it. And these days on my youngest one, all the time when he's at home, you don't know what work he is. But, and that's a lot of what goes on in the volunteer world. Unless something can change, I haven't heard about it. And not taking anything off the paid guys or anything. But in this state, in this country, there's more volunteers, statistically wise, to come out here and do this for nothing than there are paid. Am I not right? So, with that being, and that's a lot of us got hard. I don't know whether I got hard or just stupid, because I've been in this 40 years.
part of it is that noggin, man.
That's what's hard in it. Yeah.
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 Yeah, I know you.
I hardly ever talk to you. I don't know what it is there, James, about you.
Let's
Gentlemen, like I said, for me it's gonna boil down to, some kind of long term plan.
Right.
Okay.
Ms. Laura's gonna be right back here telling me the same thing over and over and over again. If we don't develop some kind of long term planning, to overcome this, once again, we're gonna be right back in here. It's gonna fall into a budgetary hole every year. And that's just the harsh reality of it. What I'd like to do is
kind of need a cost of living increase.
Try to get,
cost of fire EOC increase.
I drop back to my ultimate wage work goal. That water line costs more money every year. I don't care if nothing else happens. That cost of water, that water line's going up every year. Don't matter. So we got to increase. You can either increase it, 3 cents or late. Down the road, some board's gonna have to increase it 50 cents or $1.
Right.
So I'd rather, it's kind of like, eating that frog. I'd rather eat it early in the morning, get it over with, than, have to take a bite of it all day long. That's my opinion, and that's, like I said, that's my recommendation to the board, is to let's sit down and try to work out some kind of long-term solution. So, maybe we could make Ms. Laura happy on the
Well, I appreciate all the input, and I think we all are on the same page, and we have the same wants. It's just making it work out. But we got,
I don't, because I've already talked to, you know, the both.
I mean, I know we.
Both of my, I think, one, two, three. The three that impact on, in my area, in fact. So I don't have any questions on that.
I mean, I know the needs. I talk to mine periodically, pretty frequent. And I see, like, about a month ago, we had the chicken fundraiser. When I talked to y'all then, you know, y'all need, we'd like to have another station. So we're going to go on. Gonna throw it out there big. It's a dual purpose building too. With no parking. Right. So I mean, the needs are unlimited, and this is just a small group if you look at the Cole County budget where the needs are. So, but I'm sympathetic. I understand the volunteer situation. We got some more groups having to come in to meet with us. I'm sorry, I'm not trying to cut you off. I just know they're going to be coming through the door here in a little bit. But there's nothing we can give you a firm answer on, because we got to look at the whole budget of everything to see how we can adjust what and do what we can do. Is there anything else you got, Bob?
I mean, budget,
but keep on. Let's go. You got a short time to get there. I'm just saying we're going to have some others coming in here. So.
All right, I'm going to skip over to the emergency operations budget and just let y'all know, I don't know if Ms. Laura told y'all, on the legislative side, I've been named the chairman of the legislative branch for the emergency managers for the state. If it's all right with y'all.
Well, that's okay. That means you can get more money to help these guys then. That sounds like a perfect opportunity.
You'll be there where the money is, so you can grab it up.
My extended cussing sessions up there must have paid.
Now y'all know exactly.
Does that give you more clout next year in the legislature?
Yeah. And you know, I'll get into, you know, doing the 911 stuff and, you know, the fire guys, you know, all those.
Good. Anyway. Congratulations.
Okay. In the past year, Rankin County Emergency Operations has solidified its position as leader in emergency response and support in Mississippi at the county, state, at the county and state level for disasters, as well as technical rescue response. The volume of calls continues to increase, as does the requirements of specialized training. I am requesting that the board provide an additional employee that would increase emergency response capability and training of personnel for Rankin County emergency responders. It is also my recommendation that the board allow me the opportunity to explore the calls to harden the Rankin County Emergency Operations Center to protect the investment of the 911 infrastructure housed at the EOC and to increase the safety of personnel operating during hazardous events. That being said, you know, the EOC, of course, works closely with all of the fire departments, both volunteer and paid guys. And pretty much we kind of set the standard for everybody in the state, and that's a lot of this credit's due to these guys. If y'all remember, you know, a little over a year ago in April, with the help of these guys, Rankin County was able to put 200 responders on the ground in Pearl when they got struck, in Pearl and Richland, when they got struck by the tornado. 36 hours later, we had a 154 man team depart Rankin County and go help up in Lexington. We're the only ones that can do that, only ones that have that capability. So, and like I said, you know, we're, you know, operate within a 10 county system, but, you know, the majority and the heart, I guess you would say, for the responders comes from Rankin County. I mean, you know, when they, you know, sit down and do their operational planning stuff and all their tabletop stuff, they're looking at, you know, how Rankin County handles stuff. There's several times during the year, and hopefully this won't happen this year, but typically, there'll be a multi-agency response in different parts of the county where every municipality is involved, you know, fighting a brush fire, and every volunteer fire department is involved fighting a brush fire. And we'll also have counties, our neighboring counties involved. And, you know, these guys coordinate those attacks, you know, and that's what it is. I mean, you know, I hate to say it, but, you know, you're in a pretty good position if a disaster strikes, you know, being in Rankin County, because you're going to have some good qualified people, you know, headed your way. Other than that, I've got a breakdown. Should I stop there? Y'all got any questions so far?
No, I think we've set the mark. Set the mark high on, like I say, where our EOC and department is. I think that goes back to, goes without saying.
Just going on my line item explanations, 401 to 470, that's just an estimate on that. Of course, that could change up or down. 475 through 480, that's just travel and lodging. 503, that's the upgrade and repair some of the satellite phones that we have. 510 is just a increase in utilities. 540, that's a $10,000 increase to find and fix the repair leak at the EOC shop. And when I say that, I'm going to stop right there real quick, because I put in money to examine hardening the EOC structure, the actual EOC. Of course, you know, we've got, you know, a $1.8 million piece of equipment, you know, in the room down there. And we've also going to have, well, one-tenth of an $11 million, so another $1 million. So you're looking at $2.5 million worth of equipment down there.
Mm-hmm.
The other day I went in there and one of the cameras was blinking. And I walked down the hall to check it out, and, you know, that was water had poured through there on one of the cameras. So It's not unusual for, you know, after a rainstorm to have three or four leaky places in that EOC. And, you know, like I said, you know, we're going to dread the day that we walk in there and there's a leak that actually has happened in that equipment room.
Mm-hmm.
You got with Johnny, and he's been over there trying to find the...
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's, like I said, all we're doing is, you know, repairing it. I mean, we can't predict that, you know, where the leak's going to happen, so, you know,
we just... Does it need a new roof?
I would say, you know, at a minimum, a new roof. But, like I said, I would, you know, I know I advocated a few years ago, you know, to actually harden the structure, which is, you know, whether that's an exoskeleton around it or something, because, you know, you're talking about, you know... We got personnel in there during, you know, tornadic events, and it's basically a stucco building. And also, you've got, you know, almost $3 million of equipment.
So when it was built years ago, it wasn't built to like an EOC type?
No, it's stucco walls on the outside.
And how old is it?
Oh.
It's probably 25, 30 years old.
Yeah.
Like I said, I just, you know, want to remind everybody, that's, you know, I think one of the biggest threats, you know, to the county. I mean, because if we lose that 911, it, you know, once again, that's not going to be pretty either. So, like I said, I'd like permission to move forward, if, you know, if y'all see fit, you know, on hardening that.
What line item have you that you got that on?
Well, I didn't have that. It's on my budget in my request letter.
Yeah, but you don't have a.
So I don't have.
You don't have any dollar figure.
No, I have no dollar. I hadn't talked to anybody else. Well, I'm throwing it out there to y'all. If y'all, you know, see fit to where I could, you know, put that in there, so I could find out how much it's going to cost. Once again, that comes into the, you know, long term funding and long term planning. I mean, I don't know that we could get it done this year, but, you know, we've got to do something. I mean, it's a threat that's hanging out there. Continuing on, line item 544, is service and maintenance fees. 644 is purchase a new portable air compressor. 680 is an increase in tires and tubes. 690, electronic supplies and repairs, and purchase of wireless headsets for our dispatchers. 691 uniform, 917 is 8 GPS radios, 919, office furniture and equipment is to replace the damaged tables and chairs in the training room. And, you know, on that, apparently, some people that come in there in the training room apparently don't understand that those tables are not rated for whatever their weight is and broken. So, of course, y'all know, we built, put all that in with, you know, furniture that we can, that I got from surplus property. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you've ever tried surplus property, it's hit and miss. You know, one day it's a right. gold mine out there, and the next day it's a, you know, a desert with, you know, nothing of any use to anybody out there. 921's purchase a new ice maker and a storage unit. I say a new ice maker. The one that we have there in the building is, you know, kind of hit and miss. It's broke down, you know, almost constantly this year, but we would like to get one that is dedicated for 911, because if somebody's having an event out there, if we've got another emergency event that happens, you know, it's kind of hard to go back here and bust up somebody's, you know, wedding party or something to go in there and start filling our ice unit. So we'd like a, you know, to have our own one, you know, and put it out in the shop.
That's under what? Which one?
921. 922 is three generators and installation at the Crossroad, Langford, Monterey locations. These are generators that have been on the tower sites for 20 years, and we'd like to change those out and probably rotate those into fire departments or make those trailer mount units that are, you know, they're still good generators, but, you know, they're getting a little long in the tooth. And, you know, when your maintenance costs, you know, start increasing, that's just something you got to look at. One of them has, we're going to have to replace the muffler on it. And it was something like, I think, $450 to, you know, replace the muffler, and the parts are getting hard to find and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, if we could get those in and, you know, rehab them and, you know, get them, you know, they're, like I said, they're still good. They're not high mileage units by no means, but, you know, it would be good, you know.
Would that operate the entire facilities? Is that the type of generator
you're
talking?
Most of them, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they're all the big Caterpillars.
Gotcha. Okay.
And the addition of two new warning sirens, location, we don't know exactly where we'd put them. We'd just, you know, give it to Cooper and let him, you know, kind of sort that out. And the funding to relocate a third. We've been working with Pearl. I know they've put some, and depending on where the annexation is, and they've moved, you know, like Pearl and Brandon have moved and a siren in, and we'll move one out so we don't have, you know, a redundant siren, you know, right across the road from each other. So
you're talking about trying to get some new sirens?
Yeah.
How many are you thinking?
Two. Okay. Two new ones and the money to relocate a third. And that's...
There's not any more, there's not been any more grants or anything come available like for the last, like we did on the last wave way back, have they?
We have, it goes through a cyclic period, you know, once you've gotten a grant, and, you know, it's usually about a year or so, they just pretty much kind of, I wouldn't say, well, I'm going to say it, they kind of blackball you and, you know, and let somebody else kind of have the chance at it. So, you know, we may be getting back in the cycle where we should be able to possibly get some funding this year. We just have to wait and see how it shakes out.
So, because we see we got, that was five before, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, on the last purchases.
And those of you that don't know how they're located, we come up with where our ideas are they need to be, and then it was it FEMA decides.
No, we send it over to Lance Cooper, and
yeah,
he plots it out on the map, and
right,
it's the elevation and the wind direction and the population that circle covers.
But the final word is from MEMA, isn't that right?
No, it's
FEMA.
Usually from Lance Cooper.
No, last time we came here, they moved
will them. They'll tell you the guidelines that you got to meet. Once
they moved
you,
them last time.
Once you meet those guidelines, yeah, I mean, if you're not following right within their guidelines, they'll tell you to move.
Right, that's what I said, last time after we got it all, so they went and shuffled them all around.
Yeah, they moved some around and things like that, tweaked them out.
Yeah, but that, when it passes, you know, our recommendations, that's something that Cooper and Nemo kind of hash out the final details.
Right.
All right.
That's, any questions on the EOC budget?
No, I guess we're gonna do a tax increase to fund all this.
What?
But now, as far as the budget goes, if we need to do something to the building, do we need those numbers?
Well, we'd have to have the numbers.
Whether we roof it or harden it or whatever?
Yeah, we'd have to have that, but there's no way for, I mean.
There's no way to have that number.
No way to get that number right now, unless, I guess let's go through, see what we've got versus what we.
You don't even have a vague idea what you're talking about, to roof it or to harden it.
I mean, you can probably get a pretty rough estimate on roofing it, that wouldn't be too tough. Hardening it is gonna be the tougher.
Yeah.
I mean, if you got $2 million worth of equipment.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I get it. I get it every time it rains, I'm sitting back here just hoping, you know.
Can you move just a little spot down there at the safe room, just to?
There's no safe spot, I can tell you.
No, down at the safe room.
Oh.
Well, I would at least look at a new roof or repairing the roof or something.
Yeah, we have to do that, I mean, I don't see where.
Well, I mean, you know, the roof, you know, is continually, you know, that's ongoing repair, I mean.
Right.
Well, I mean, you got, that's what I'm saying, you got to put a new roof either way. It's not like you're gonna have to put a roof on it.
So that number should be pretty easy to come up with, just get you a couple of different, or have Johnny come up with it.
Can't come up, if we can't harden it, which I guess would be hardening the roof too.
Yeah.
You still, either way, we gotta have a, it's not like you'll have to have a roof.
Yeah, the equipment just needs to be protected.
I don't have, I wouldn't even know where to start guessing what hardening the building would cost.
I don't even know what that means, so. Is there a legal term?
You know, it's a soft building.
Would that be kind of like a safe room hardening type thing?
I would think so.
Yes.
All right, y'all ready to go with 911?
Yeah.
Sure.
All right, on the 911, Rankin County continues to lead Mississippi in innovation. Our 911 system is one of the most secure in the state.
See you later, Jack.
This year, we have enhanced the capability to recover from disasters by continuing to receive emergency calls if connectivity at a host site is disabled. This also presented Rankin County the ability to offer hosted 911 solutions, which were once only available through AT&T and other counties in the state. E911 hosting is now gaining popularity and is recommended in the peer committee reports. In November, we made a presentation to the Mississippi Association of Supervisors, and it was very well received. We continue to get numerous calls and emails from counties inquiring about our regional 911 hosting and how we have helped to increase the interoperability and efficiency. We have been honored at the request to make presentations and to share our innovative progress with state and local governments, and look forward to our future engagements. To keep up with the technology has placed a strain on all counties throughout the state, and Rankin County is not immune. The peer committee also recommends consolidation or co-location of public safety answering points to save money. Rankin County currently supports 6 PSAPs, and the benefits of co-location or consolidation of the facility would be a tremendous savings to Rankin County, because there would be no duplication of equipment or excessive routing and connectivity costs. It would also make us compliant for any future funding that could become available. It is our recommendation that Rankin County begin to explore consolidation or co-location of PSAPs. And for your benefit, I have attached a copy of the last peer report on 911 funding. The Rankin County radio system was built in 1996, currently undergoing a full upgrade. Should be online October 2015. This will make the county P25 compliant and also increase statewide coverage as needed during prisoner transport and emergency deployments. Radio upgrade system and hardware, software will be covered under a full factory warranty for 1 year, thus allowing Rankin County to see a reduction of an estimated $200,000 in the budgeted annual maintenance cost until approximately October 2016. Future radio upgrades are another thing to consider when exploring consolidated or co-located PSAPs. Again, the cost savings to Rankin County would be remarkable. Legislative efforts to increase funding for Mississippi 911 failed yet again in 2015. However, we're continuing to pursue this issue with the state and local leaders throughout Mississippi and the surrounding areas. It is our hope that the new 911 funding structure will be passed in 2016 legislative session. So that's where we're at on that. So I can drop back and tell them, like I said, I included the peer committee, you know, report in there for y'all. That's one of the things that, you know, the legislators have said that that's where they want everything to start steering towards. And, you know, that's, you know, just another of the ticking time bombs that's, you know, headed our way. Mm-hmm. You know, I know I've talked to, you know, some of y'all about this before. The more it's talked about, the more everybody, including the legislators, looking at cost savings, and it's just going to be a push down eventually down to the county levels where they're going to tell you, you know, you're not going to operate, you know, six PSAPs like we're doing now. They're going to tell you that you're going to have two, and you can either have the two or they'll just keep the money. That's what it's going to come to. Yeah. I can smell that coffee a brewing already. So, like I said, you know, the best thing I can advise you guys is, you know, for us to start, you know, getting out ahead of it. You know, the funding streams, you know, impact all the municipalities. You know, our commitment, you know, with them, or our financial support, you know, to the municipalities is significant. Like I said, you know, pretty much, you know, my partnership, you know, on the fire and police side, you know, and the 911 is, you know, pretty solid with, you know, all the municipalities. But the issue is going to be a political one. It's not a emergency service issue. We all see it, we all understand it, but, you know, it's going to fall back to a political issue. So that's what you're going to, you know, have to look at. And whoever's up there, you know, the next term, we're going to have to find a way to politically start getting these municipalities to understand, you know, there's fixing to be a new reality.
Right.
And they can either, you know, partner in, or, you know, if they have the financial wherewithal, or, and, you know, if they, you know, if it's their wish and desire to operate independently without funding, well, that's going to be their option. And that's what it's going to come down to. Mm-hmm. And like I said, it may not be this year, but it's on the way. And it's probably going to happen this term if the lieutenant governor from Rankin County gets reelected. Huh. That's one of his issues that, you know, every time we go up there and talk about funding, he starts talking about, you know, how can we make it more efficient? How can we do, you know, work jointly with everybody? And, you know, he's gotten a peer report, he's read it, and he's got a, you know, like I said, it's, you know, it is what it is. It's reality. So that's just something coming down the pipe.
All right.
I know
you gave us a lot.
I'm full of great news today. I'm glad I'm the bearer of all this news, and I hope. Yeah,
just wait till Judge Broom gets up here.
Yeah. Is he here already?
He's out here hiding behind the post.
All right, that's 911. Has anybody got any specifics on my 911 stuff? Like I said, it's, you know, and I know, you know, Mr. Keith, that all of my stuff kind of overlaps. Fire ties into 911, 911 ties into fire, and all ties into EOC, because all that kind of runs together. So,
kind of all one same, yeah.
You know, that's why everybody gets to cuss me, in case you're wondering.
So, I've never cussed you. Doesn't mean I won't, but I haven't yet.
I thank you, though.
All right.
Two more.
Cut loose.
Two more.
Now.
EMS. EMS, this is, y'all know I reassigned Brian to EMS. We've got three budget requests, and this is funded through that. One, physio control life pack 15, that's an ALS monitor. Two, Lucas chest compressors. And four, county volunteer firemen to EMT school. We're doing that with the escrow money left over for the next fiscal year, or this fiscal year. Okay, well.
We have to spend it or pay it.
Yeah, so we're trying to get that spent, and I think that's, you know, what this is, just kind of.
All we can do is spend what comes in.
Yeah, and reminder on the, you know, the EMS budget, we've got the elephant in the room. FY16, the ambulance contract will run out also. So I'll throw that out there. So that's great news on that. Now, I'd like to finish on a great high note. Vector control, what do y'all want to do? I put in the same amount as last year. I think it was 300 and something thousand, and I just left it at that. But if y'all are happy with the company that's ongoing, and that is, I know we're going to have, you know, some new board members come on, and this is, I'm not going to make a recommendation probably until they get on board, and just in case something happens, but you know, when they come on board, I just like the opportunity to come back and say, okay, well, I've got six trucks back there. You know, if they're happy, you know, if the majority of the board is happy with the way things go or has gone with them and wants to redo it, then, you know, I'd like to, you know, re-examine the vector control after those. It'd be my recommendation after whoever gets here, and we'll talk more about that then. But
yeah, you really have to have something in there already anyway, so.
Yeah, so I just recommend funding it at the same level we did last year.
Right, and then make that decision.
That covers in case we make it, is there any change, yeah, I would think. What do you think, Laura?
Yeah.
Pretty much. But I'm content. I'm fine with what we're doing right now. I'm getting just.
Like I said, the only recommendation I'm going to make on that is, you know, 6 months from now, if the board is still happy, you know, let's do something with that equipment that.
Yeah.
You know, we've got
that. No, that's kind of the way we left it, and I think this has been a good trial test.
Yeah.
Time
kind of a little too soon to know for sure.
Right.
Right.
The mosquito season and feel
right.
Good about where it is now.
But right.
Yeah, I think we're a little early to make a full determination.
Right. And I'd like the new board to have some input on that also, as well.
It's perfect timing. I think it's perfect timing when all of it came through. So.
Yeah. Yeah, and it'll be, you know, whenever the. You know, the three new folks come in, you know,
right.
I can catch them up, and, you know, we tell them where I'm at or where we're at, and
some of them
have you already conceded this race?
Me? Yeah. Have I conceded?
You've already decided this race here.
What race?
He said you're saying the three new, so I guess what he's saying is you've already conceded knowing who's going to be sitting down there, so.
Oh, I figured there's going to be three new ones. That's.
I know that.
Well, I'm sorry. Yeah, you're. Hey, I'm staying out of that one.
I'm just picking on Jay.
Look, I picked on Jay one day, and I thought he was going to come down here. I just said, I just guarantee that I know that there's going to be three new ones.
Well, guys, I know. I ran over a lot, you know, and I don't know if y'all had any more questions. Whether it's on fire,
no.
EOC 911. I know I usually give you guys a lot of information, and it usually takes a while.
There's plenty of reading material.
Well, not only that, you had your, and again, Tim, thank you. If you would tell all the fire chiefs out there, thank you for coming, and I'm gonna give them a call too, because that does mean a lot for us. You know,
I check on that roof too.
Does mean a lot for us to have, you know, the room full to be able to see what we go through and see what you go through, because really it doesn't mean anything unless we have you guys out there.
And this is basically one department. In a sense, yeah.
And hopefully, this is just me personally. You know, this is a relatively high profile meeting. I'm looking at that type of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's my intention to get more people engaged in
Right, and that's good. That's exactly.
Not had that before, that's good.
Well, let's work, everybody working together. That way, because we're on both sides, I mean, we're all working together on this thing for the people.
And same with municipalities, I mean, I've got a call at 1:00 in the morning, and that girl was 64, work out in Pearl, supply water to them.
Right. That's right, and which is, it's all Rankin County, so.
We appreciate you all coming. Bob, you gave us plenty to think about.
Sure did, Bob. We always love seeing you.
It's no different than any other year, brother. Still my love, baby.
We're right on schedule, and Judge Broom has entered the room. Right on schedule.
You got it.
Thank you all for coming.
Appreciate it.
I believe next we have the Honorable Judge Broom, Mr. Paul Bowen. Glad to have y'all.
Good morning.
I took the cape off and flew over, but I.
How are you, sir?
Hello, sir. Good. Hey, Craig. We'll sit up here.
Really, I'm at y'all's mercy. We thank y'all for your support and everything. Really, in terms of where we are this year, we're bringing in about $437,000 in outside money directly into the budget from our grants and other drug court activities and whatnot. We've got an additional program that we're starting that won't come through the county budget. It's coming through a national nonprofit, the 0-3 organization. They'll be us helping to assign somebody outside of Rankin County. They'll be responsible for management for with regard to development community assets for infants that are in foster care. Y'all may have seen something in the paper the last few days about it. But one of the things that we're going to be doing in the next year that y'all may be interested in knowing is that we will be working with a group to enrich the services and kind of make the citizens aware of the services that are available for kids, and working with a group called Excel by Five. You've probably seen some of these communities and counties around the state that may be designated as an Excel by Five county or city. And it's a group that was started by Governor Barber and Chevron back in 2005. To do early childhood development, and it's a partnership, if you will, with the hospitals, the community health, mental health providers like Region 8, private providers, doctors, daycares, all of those things, basically for everybody to try and provide access to resources and make people aware of resources and identify children who may be at risk and try and mitigate those risk factors. And it's really a good community boosting program too, because it makes everybody aware of the resources that the county has. And one of the things that we're very fortunate for, and just taking a quick survey of it, and we're not too far into this, we're really just in the preliminary stages of it now, is Our community looks very good compared to others, so I don't think we're going to have quite as far to go as some of those will. But it's a situation where a lot of our families, as you know, are moving into the county, and they don't know what resources we have within the county, and particularly for young kids, trying to get them ready for school and for school age. And the most formative years that we have are 0-3 and 0-5, and pretty much after 5 you're on autopilot. So whoever took care of you when you were five and under, you should go give them a hug, because they probably are responsible for you sitting where you are today.
There's no question.
Or you can slap them if you don't like it.
Or somebody else can slap them for me, I guess.
She's just calling on me a lot right now.
She is. The tables have turned.
Yes.
Yeah, the child.
My hummingbird feeders are empty. Will you please go take them down and bring them where I can fill them?
Can you get some bird food? Yeah.
It's the most important thing of the morning.
Well, it was the most important thing for you to get your driver's license, and now you've got to tell her that you're taking hers from her. So, it's the fun just continues, doesn't it? But really, that's what we've got. We've had some success stories over the last year. We've completed our juvenile detention alternatives initiative review of our detention facility minimum standards with the state. The legislature did not adopt them this last time because I think, as Bob may have pointed out, the legislature killed more than they signed off on this year. So 80% of the legislation died on deadline day, and this was one of them, but we will be going back through that. The good news is that we received an email the other day from one of the national consultants, and she said that she had literally toured hundreds of facilities over the last few years, and she would rank ours as one of the tops in the country. So,
excellent.
That's a great.
Where's the press today?
Yeah. Well, I think we may have an opportunity for that later on. So they're coming, but. She was very complimentary of that, and she was also very complimentary of Michelle Rhodes, who's left us, unfortunately, and the sheriff to go find six-figure jobs for everyone. And if you need a six-figure job, give her your resume. She's working with Carolyn Boatler now at temp staff. So we've transitioned over with our detention center to Randy Gray as the director, so he's been on the team for a couple of weeks now, so things are going fine, and we're continuing a lot of the programs that we had on our abuse and neglect side. We have gotten funding through the AOC to continue a representation project for parents who are involved with our abuse and neglect cases, and the young lady who works for Mission First that's assigned to us has just been received a national award. We'll receive it on August the 1st from the American Bar Association Young Lawyer Division National Child Advocate Award. So we should be getting some good press in Rankin County out about that. I would point out that Paul Bowen, our court administrator, Paul, take a courtesy, was the court administrator of the year last year. For the state of Mississippi, so he got to be recognized there. Let's see, we've had some other recognitions of other staff. Our senior DYS counselor, who works for the Department of Human Services, was selected as the Outstanding Counselor of the Year for the state of Mississippi and received that award back in February. So we're very fortunate that we have a lot of good folks working for us. And thanks to y'all, we have the resources to do it. So.
And Paul might want to step up here and tell what the judge has been.
Oh, well.
He's being honest for, because he just received the Chief Justice Award this year at the Bar Association. So he just got that award.
Yeah, that and a $1.50 will get you a Coke if you find it on sale.
$1.59.
Yeah. Yeah. But thank you.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Both of you.
Those are the kind of things I really, like I was picking, but I wasn't picking about the press being here. Those are the things that are positive that you really want out there to show people
what their services are.
Yeah, what the services are paying for and what the quality. People we have that are providing these services and helping make sure they're going in the right direction. I really, right. you know, we hear the negative side and people fussing, we don't hear these things. So congratulations. I wish, like I say, we need to make sure this is known sometimes.
Well, we've got a good group. You know, everything, like any organization, it's dynamic. People come and go. So, but we, one of the things that, you know, we do have challenges on a state level particularly. If you haven't seen it, you will be seeing it, and it'll become more of an issue as the fall and spring comes on. The state has, the governor's office has entered into a consent decree with a group formerly known as Children's Rights of New York in a lawsuit called Olivia Y. And that's a foster care lawsuit. And as part of that consent decree, the state basically acknowledged that they were in contempt for failure to meet certain guidelines that they agreed to 8 years ago. And as part of that, they are going to be changing the way they do business at the Department of Human Services and Family and Children Services particularly. They're going to have a cabinet level position that's going to be reporting directly to the governor, and the person that gets that job has to be vetted by a group called Public Catalyst out of Michigan, who's going to come down and do a 4-month study of the state and then make a recommendation to the governor and of who might be a qualified candidate, and they're going to waive the salary caps in case any of you want to apply.
Is that the case Rusty Fortenberry's working?
It is. Yeah. And then it is going to be submitted to a panel of three of the plaintiffs to get their blessing on that person's hire, and then that person will report to the governor. And it is believed that ultimately privatization of the department will be occurring. So at least some aspect of abuse and neglect cases. So whether there's some question as to whether legally they can farm out investigations, but they may be able to farm out the foster care portion and some of the case management portions. But anyway, there's big changes on the horizon in that regard, but I suspect you will not hear any of that until after November. But there's in the consent decree a provision for the governor to consider the calling of a special session, because I think he's going to have some statutory changes to make that happen. So,
Tom, is there precedent in other states for privatization of foster care?
Yeah, they've done it. it's all over the map. You can hear good, bad, and horror stories depending on who you talk to. But it's a who knows where it's going to end up, but I can just tell you there's going to be a lot of change, and I don't know how this is going to impact the day-to-day operations. This is all recent news as of like 2 days ago that this came about. So I think we're all still trying to just digest what's going on, but ultimately I think I can read the handwriting on the wall because it says privatization in the consent decree. I'm pretty sure I know what that means. So I don't know how that impacts us, but we have gotten pretty much fully staffed in our local office with our DHS workers. So, you know, we're doing fairly well in terms of our investigations and whatnot. We have, and turnover is less than it was. We still have a significant turnover among the state workers, but generally we're working through it pretty good. So, but keep your ear to the ground on that. If you hear anything, let us know, because mm-hmm. that is one thing that dramatically impacts us more than anything else is what the state provides in that regard, because it could very well be that the state may push that cost and expense back down to the county, because these things are extremely expensive. They're spending about $320 million a year on this, and I'm sure they'd like to divide that by 80 too. So we may have a vested interest in making sure that nothing gets shoved back down on the county, because I don't think we could afford to take on that task. And that seems to be a common theme at the Capitol. I know y'all know that. But other than that, I will report to you that the judges and the sheriffs that are in the other counties, we're housing detainees from about 27 counties in South Mississippi. On any given day, we may have four or five different counties that may have kids in the facility, and the judges that I've spoken with give nothing but high praise for the sheriff and his staff and the court staff with the kids, because quite honestly, they wouldn't have to use us if they didn't want to, and they choose to use us, and they seem to be getting good results for their kids. So it's a win-win situation for us, because we're charging them a daily fee for housing them, so it helps pay our notes.
Right.
Or at least cover some of it.
Have some expenses, you're right. I've shared that with people.
Yeah.
Throughout the county.
Yeah.
That's another thing they're unaware of, and good knowledge.
Well, and I'm glad that you mentioned that, is that I failed to mention one of the programs that we started with the court and the sheriff, and Michelle was a huge advocate in the midst of, was a program called Positive Behavioral Interventions and Supports, PBIS. And basically, it's common sense. You know, you come to work to do your job, to get a check so you can take care of things. You don't come to get talked down to and mean to. So you incentivize somebody to do the right thing and give them some praise, whether it's just a pat on the back or a thank you or whatever. And, you know, sanction them or redirect them if they need to change. And it's been a program that's been in some of the schools, but it's never been in a detention facility anywhere. And we're the first juvenile detention facility to ever have it. And we were recognized in Boston at the International PBIS program as a program that should be looked at both here in the U.S. and around the world. So the folks down at USM in Reach, Mississippi, Selena Morrell, who helped us implement it and still helping us implement it, have done some wonderful work there. So that's another good attaboy for the county.
Good.
I have a question somebody asked me. Maybe you can answer it. How much has House Bill 585 cost the county?
Ooh. I couldn't really say in terms of the impact on it juvenile-wise, because it really hasn't impacted us in the juvenile arena. The sheriff and the circuit judges, Judge McDaniel, may could give you a better estimate. Obviously, and James Rutland here could maybe tell you, we obviously are seeing more inmates coming through, because they're coming through on shorter periods of time. When they violate probation, they're coming in 90 days or 30 days or something like that.
That's the sentences they're getting.
Yeah.
They're actually staying with me longer.
Longer than that, because they're getting brought in before they get adjudicated on those. So, there's a cost associated with it.
I just
don't know what the numbers are.
I don't even know how you would put them together.
I can tell you this, where I have seen it, is we have a large number of parents who have been incarcerated who are being released from the Department of Corrections custody, and they're returning home, some with some success and some without. Some are just here for a brief stay before they go back. We're seeing a lot more of those folks. The other thing that we're seeing is that we have parents who are on active probation right now. And this is a problem for us, is that the Department of Corrections does not do observed drug screens when they're monitoring somebody on a probation. And if you don't do an observed drug screen and have somebody in the room, the drug screen is useless, and we'll have somebody who's on active probation, and we're testing them, and they're testing positive for marijuana, cocaine, whatever, and we report it, and sometimes they take action and sometimes they don't. And I understand their problem is that even though they may be testing positive, they can't return them back to the penitentiary. So that's where we're getting hung up in that loop.
Right. Richard.
And I also have to compliment Mr. Rutland here. He and his staff at the jail have worked wonders with our program out at Pelahatchie and helped provide services out there for us and helping us with our high tunnels and stuff out there, getting those set up and established. And he's bringing us lunch and dinner out there. If you need a bologna sandwich any day, he's the man to hook you up. Wow.
Hey, where's the press when you need them?
And Mr. Palmer, I'll compliment Mr. Palmer too, not to skip the love here. He's been out there with our youth project leadership team and driving them around and bringing them to the facilities. So we appreciate his efforts.
I thought you were going to say he was actually housed out there.
Well, I'm forbidden by law to talk about that. Right. There's a confidentiality provision. And
I understand.
If he wants to waive that, we can.
Glad to be not here for that.
Hey, look, you're qualified to run for this office, so go. Don't worry about it.
His line item is 163, correct? Okay. So you're looking at about 150.
Yeah, let me tell you a little bit about our number situation. Here's the bizarre part of all of this, and I don't know how Laura and Craig and all y'all put up with it, but several years ago, when we started our drug court program, the drug court monies were coming from AOC in the same time frame as our county fiscal year. So we got it from October 1 to September 30, whatever. All right. Well, a year and a half ago, we started getting deathly low in the drug court state budget account. And so they did a quick fix, but the quick fix to them was a fix for the adult drug courts and not the juvenile drug courts. But what they did was we were not gonna be able to make the budget work out until the county fiscal year. So they basically cut us off and rolled us back to the state fiscal year. So we lost almost 4 months of funding there, and they cut our amount, and then they told us, well, you can go apply for another, we're gonna work with the governor to get this other pot of money available. Well, they did get that pot of money available. However, it was 7 months down the road before that became available. So what it has done is it has flip-flopped, and between Paul and Laura, I'm not sure who understands it more, but they understand it. Some of the money comes in a county fiscal year, some of it comes in a state fiscal year, and some of it comes in whenever the Department of Public Safety ever figures out they want to give it to us again. And so far, it's all worked out time-wise, but it's a juggling act with us trying to keep up with the budgets and y'all's budget, because we keep telling them we have to budget on a county fiscal year,
right,
not the state and all, but we have two different
spreadsheets. And I may have been out of the room when you did, when they discussed this, but the new employee with Grant, is that?
Yeah, what we've got is we've got somebody who's retiring.
Okay.
And we have a part-time position that we have not filled because of this juggling of the money.
Right.
So what we are looking at, because she's one of our most seasoned persons, is looking to bring her back in after her time frame runs as a part-time position, and then bringing in the staff position, working with our family drug court.
And that's through a grant?
Yeah, it's through a grant, through AFC.
And I know we've questioned that about 7 years or so that I've been on that. I guess what happens when the grant runs out, how does that work?
Well, they get relieved, because what happened, I don't know that you remember.
Two years ago, I had to let two people go. Yeah, I remember that.
Because that's when they did this flip-flop.
Yeah.
And we just cut them loose.
And I, you know, we hate to do that.
Oh,
I know you do.
Yeah, I do. But we're keenly aware.
Right.
We don't print money out there.
When it says grant.
Now, I've got some kids that do print money if y'all need any. And one thing I have noted, and you can try it on your copier, apparently when we were trying to do a receipt for somebody, we tried to photocopy a $100 bill to make a copy of it for the record.
They won't do.
The machine will not allow the money to be photocopied.
It won't. I know. Yeah. I know it won't.
Yeah. If we could figure out that, we could print our own money.
Yeah. That was the one Daryl was taking out there and all the running around all that.
Well, I don't know. It may be. But we've had.
Hit a 1 and 3 and 2 zeros.
I did. I know exactly what you're saying, because whenever we did the our arts and crafts fair, I'd have my assistant, you know, doing the checks and all that, because we had to turn it all into the state. Well, then whenever she'd start trying to print off the, you know, the money, she's like, it's blank. And I said, it's going to be blank. They're not going to let you photocopy that.
It literally catches it?
It's got a detector in there
it's
somehow.
It's got a detector.
Really?
Yeah, and it will not photocopy it.
It'll come out blank. Phew. It's like it never was there.
Yeah, it's some smart technology.
I think it's in the bill. Yeah, it's yep. You can't photocopy it.
Huh.
Yep.
You can use the old
copier.
Yes, if you use the old ones.
Not to be outdone, we don't have any criminals in the room. they just use their scanner and scan it on their computer and then load it up, and they can print it on their printer that way.
So there is a way to get around that.
Oh, yeah, but the quality's not as good as our copier. That's right.
I understand.
But
we gotta figure that out. The paper had a lot to do with it.
Yeah, you can, but you can buy some good quality cotton paper that's pretty close.
See, I thought we were going to be able to fund everything everybody wants.
Yeah.
Well, if they pass marijuana in Mississippi, which is apparently going to be on the ballot.
Just kidding.
Then we're going to have marijuana and moonshine, and we're going to ask for y'all to give us a resort designation status, and we're going to use our high tunnels to grow some of the best that we got.
Oh, man.
And they really will be high tunnels.
That'd be the happiest place in probably the state, wouldn't it?
Happy, 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 yeah.
That's right. Yeah, we probably could fund all of county government on that.
Bologna sandwiches would be.
Well, that's the steaks and caviar.
Big time.
I need to talk to you.
Because they'll be hungry.
That's right.
Okay.
Do y'all ever let Janice out of the corner, or is she always in trouble?
She loves sitting back there.
Is it time out?
She loves sitting back there.
There must be some bulletproof.
That's all I'm hoping.
Yeah, I'm in a dangerous spot.
But that's about it. I got to get back. If y'all don't have anything, I got to put the cape back on. We got people waiting.
I don't have anything.
We appreciate
you,
the visit and the information.
Thank you.
Great.
Well, thank y'all.
Thank you for what y'all do. Thank you, Paul.
And we will, like I said, we will be, we're kind of in the planning stages right now with this state 0-3 and Excel by 5, but we'll be getting in touch with y'all and invite y'all over for some planning sessions and talking sessions, because y'all know the resources out there, and you know what people need and what they don't need. And it really is, I think more than anything, that we're also going to be having the chamber involved. It's a great public relations tool, because if people see the communities rallying around, which they always do here in our county, it can only promote the growth.
So, where did Michelle go?
She went to work for temp staff. They created a new, well, for Carolyn Butler, they created a new executive recruiting division. And
right.
She was going to be in charge of that.
I got you.
And she just couldn't pass up the money.
Right.
Although we've told her that if she decides to leave, we will kick the door down and let her come back in.
Yeah, because she was a winner out there for sure.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Yeah. Yeah, she did great. But
I just didn't know where she had gone.
Yeah,
to.
She's starting with them next week.
Okay.
But it's a new division, and it's, like I said, six-figure income recruiting.
So yeah, well,
if you need a new job, give her a resume. She'll hook you up.
Mm. Thank you, Judge.
I don't know, Rutland. Do y'all let her carry the gun anymore? I think she's still a reserve, so I'm not gonna go try her out. And I think she's qualified on the taser too, so I'm not interested in seeing that. Yeah. And Johnny Jones is working on our air conditioner, and we're thankful that it's working this week. And because if it weren't, we would be needing some graves out at the state hospital.
So. Thank you, Judge.
Yeah.
Thank you.
No bond money. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. John Jones. Is he coming up?
All right, Johnny.
There he is. Come
perfect timing.
Forward.
Come on up.
Johnny Jones.
That's perfect timing. Good. How you doing?
We're good.
What line item we got there?
151.
Thank you, man.
Me and Miss Laura spoke on a couple occasions about the budget for maintenance, and it's pretty cut and dry. I proposed pretty much a duplicate budget for the upcoming year. Me and her discussed some of the overlap between our buildings and repairs and some of the capital outlay that we have. So it's actually going to appear, you correct me if I'm wrong or misstating, it's going to appear that we're actually going to reduce some of the maintenance budget, but it's actually going to go back into capital. Need to try and maintain that as much as possible for this year's been a little bit more than the normal. We've had some major repairs. Of course, it's the only thing we can do is have that money in case something breaks, you know. But as far as anything to be increased, I haven't had any requests for that. And, I think we're gonna try to increase some of course, Ms. Laura's always handled that. We're gonna have a percentage increase each year for our utilities and cell phones. And whatnot. But
how many employees are under you?
Three. Well, four including me. Did put a request in for another vehicle this year. My vehicle's getting some miles on it. And I don't mind driving it till the wheels fall off, but
I got a nice Crown Vic out there you've been having in a few months.
I had one. I don't know where it went.
Give him that one.
Well, I gave it to Laura. I don't know where it went. So
I have talked to Ms. Laura, and I think I have talked with the board, the last mention about the air conditioners upcoming, you know, we're getting a lot of age on our air conditioner, our heat and air equipment.
Right.
And it's going to come a time where we're going to have to actually increase that capital. It's pretty significant, because we're going to get into a situation like, for instance, we have 25 units on the jail right now that are 15 plus years old, and I think James can attest to the outages that we've had already the past 30 days. And of course, our service company is handling it, but we've omitted our compressors after 15 years of being covered under the service agreement. So therefore, each time we have a compressor go out, we have to pay for it.
Right.
Now, they do cover the labor, and they do cover the gas up to, or Freon up to 5 pounds, but anything outside of that, we pay for that as well. And as y'all are probably well aware of, you know, they're doing away. The federal government comes in and updates equipment changes, Freon changes, and R22 is a thing of the past now, kind of like, you know, R12 was. And when we get to changing units of that magnitude, it's going to get expensive. So, but outside of that, that's pretty much.
Does that service agreement that we have, does that pretty well, I mean, are we breaking even on that? Are we doing well with that? I mean, are we seeing a good benefit with a service agreement?
To be honest with you, the way the service agreement was set up in the past with past contractors, it was pretty hard on the contractor.
Right.
You know, their profit margin was not, you know, anytime you get equipment over 10 years,
right,
you know, your profit margin starts dropping.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the reason we renegotiated our contract this year on equipment, on compressors and Freon. And that was the other reason that I'd come in and requested that we look into doing new controls on this equipment to try and economize and reduce the runtime on all the equipment, even in the jail. If we can economize, of course, you know, that's less miles on your car, so
right.
to speak, and might can get more runtime out of them. But as far as the contract we have now, I think it's pretty fair and impartial to both parties as far as they're being able to make a living. I mean,
yeah.
They're there to make a living. They're not there to, you know, I guess, a non-profit, so to speak.
But, be a service.
But, right. You know, but they're doing a good job. Yeah. And they've had some challenges because our contract's a little bit different from what they're used to dealing with. But all in all, they've done a good job.
Okay, good.
And I think I'd have to have the contract right in front of me to tell how long it's for, but I think it's up for renewal again this year. I can't remember if it was 1 year or 3 years.
I think it was three, but I don't hope you do that.
Right. But yeah, we do. We will have some new line items there with the elevator. The state has mandated that we have certified inspectors of their choosing to inspect all of our elevators. And we found out after we got that done that we would then have to pay for the certificates from the state.
After you make the corrections.
After you make the corrections and pay for the pay for the inspections.
You pay for the inspections. To upgrade them to whatever
right.
they say is wrong, and you pay $75 per certificate.
How many elevators do we have?
Five. You have two in the jail. I have five altogether. It's not a big expense,
right.
By no means. It's just
to pay $75 per to get.
Is all this included in this budget that he's requesting? Okay.
And we had a couple of infractions that are no big deal.
Right.
Actually, maintenance is going to handle those. The main thing we had was our phone lines weren't communicating in any of the elevators. I don't think yours were communicating either.
I go directly straight to dispatch.
Do they? Yes, the three up the hill are not communicating with dispatch.
Hmm.
So we're going to have to get the elevator companies out. I've got a call in to them. We ain't got a scheduled date yet for them to do it. But other than that, it's pretty simplified. So.
Is he pretty much in line right now with the budget we had in for this year, the 15?
It's a little bit over that what we have, but there again, I might cut back some because of duplication in our 700 line item down here, capital projects fund.
Right.
Because like one thing I can cut out in EOC is like if the roof there that he's put in the 10,000 or 15 or whatever it is, I can remove that because that can be paid for out of the capital projects.
Correct.
Anything that you do to a building that extends its useful life.
Right.
And so there's no use duplicating those funds.
Correct. And that's
we've got a big enough deficit. So
it's kind of like you combine them instead of right. Okay. Because that's what I was going to ask earlier, even, and I was just waiting on you to come because that way it could fall under buildings and grounds.
Right. And, so. You know, whether I take a little bit out of the capital projects fund and put it back up in Johnny's so
right.
he can control it or vice versa, it really doesn't matter as long as we're not duplicating.
Correct.
Yeah. And I talked to Bob about the roof. We've got some gutters that are rusted out.
Yeah.
We've already been on the roof. And the biggest problem down there is we had some trees that grew up. And we've still got two that's got to be removed.
Right.
It's just hard to keep it clean. And I was looking into actually pressure washing that roof down there and relining those gutters and trying to get the roof resealed this year. But we held up, you know, depending on whether we put a new one on it.
Well, from what they're talking, they've got some pretty major leaks, I guess, on certain areas.
They've got two leaks. For that or you know
have you pretty much figured out where they're at or
I have
oh you have okay so yeah. we can
yeah, I know where they're at it's only one leak but it's
causing
running in the path of least resistance and it's yes. going two ways
okay
but we've had several issues down there and don't know how they're doing it but I mean we're having some pretty good circus events with cats and possums and everything else but I don't know how they're getting in there. That's been a task.
Hmm.
But either way, it could stand a new roof.
Right. Okay.
All right.
Good deal.
Thank you. All right. You got it.
Thank you, John.
Have a good day.
You too, buddy.
You too.
Right.
So, as y'all can see, though, if you look at your, not the miscellaneous, but the one that had your general county departments in it, as the old saying goes, we have too much month left over at the end of our money.
Yep.
You can see we have $751,424 that we've got to
shave.
Did
you know, the other day when we talked about that, have you gotten already with any one of them to see if we could shave anywhere, or have you already started that?
I started doing the shaving myself.
Okay.
Small things like we were just talking about, a talk with John.
Correct.
About that we need to do the shaving.
Right.
One of the things that I recommend doing is like in Bob's EOC, where he put the over 100,000 for the generators in there, she because it's not an absolute necessity. Right. They are getting older. Don't put the money in there, and then if
we've been higher than that before, though,
come back and show the need and amend the budget.
Amend the budget to reflect that.
She has to start cutting some things.
Put the money in there, then the next year,
it shows that to take it out, right?
But if we pare them back down and people come as they need it, as we have some,
right?
And we talked about those damn raises. If it can't be done out of the capital project,
that's right.
Then we make a one-time
investment, right?
So I don't think there's going to be a problem. I've already worked on it, and I've got it down to actually. And I might be a little bit stiff on some. We might have to make some changes here, but I've got it back down to where I'm within.
To prepare for the account.
Let's see.
Yeah.
Half of it.
Within $10,000 of balancing.
Really?
Yes.
That's great.
Nobody might like me when it's all over.
Painful.
Might be a little bit painful, but hey.
Well, that's like $750.
We have a good enough balance that we can do one-time repairs,
right.
One-time,
expenditures. Right.
That we can put in at that time that it's necessary without loading the budget and then it not being used. That's just like in the fire. The trucks, one truck was allowed this last year. It was ordered. Then there was the accident with the Monterey truck. We got $174,000 in on that truck from the insurance company. So that leaves us about $150,000 to put in there. They're not gonna be paid for until November. Well, we're gonna put another truck in for this year budget because we're limited on what we can spend the first quarter. If it doesn't get ordered until January, it's not gonna be paid for in this next year's budget. It's gonna, even though it's ordered,
right,
it's gonna swing into the next year. So we have some, just like the judge was talking about with his money coming in. They're bringing in their grants total around 400 and something thousand. It won't all come in this year because it's a reimbursement after we send in the paper.
Right.
And it depends on how fast the state, you know, gets the money.
Cuts the check out.
So, you know, it's moving targets. It sounds really expensive on, you know, fire right up front, but it just might not get done in the year is what they anticipate.
It is a budget?
Yeah.
It's a budget. It's your best, it's your best guesstimate on the expense side and on your. I've already talked, I did talk with the sheriff about the FEMA safe room, about scaling that budget back down. He's given me permission to do what I need to do there. I talked with Johnny about the overlapping and the money, you know. So there's a lot of things that we can do. You know, the first run is always the one where everybody asks for everything.
We're not doing that. Let's see, they're asking for 5%.
Knowing that they're not going to get everything that they request.
This is asking for 3%.
What we need to do now, we will have our regular scheduled work session next Thursday on the 30th. Need to know if y'all need to or want to meet again before then, or if you want to take that afternoon.
It's next, it's next Thursday.
Yes. Use that as another budget.
Let me look.
Probably just as well.
Yeah, I would think after the work session.
Are you bringing lunch in?
We have.
You paid.
Brought our lunch before.
Yes, we're bringing it in.
As long as you'll pay me back.
That means we're not going, that means we're not going to the Shelby County Fair.
Well, and now this is totally up to y'all. I mean, we can set another day.
Safe enough to go there. You too.
You what?
We can set another day next week.
I can't get in public right now. Why, they're after me.
Do what now?
Who is?
As Jay said, as long as it's not Monday morning.
Everybody knows Swell's team is after.
But anytime Monday afternoon or after.
Swell's team there.
I think he's gonna mess this whole budget hearing process. That's what I'm thinking. I see where we can actually make up that $750,000. That's pretty good analogy.
Okay.
What other departments, sir?
So Thursday?
I think Thursday afternoon.
We're good for ceasefire one day, one of those mornings?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Are there any other departments that y'all would like to meet with that afternoon? John said he'd be available, you know, whenever to go over his, if y'all have a need there. So many of them, there is so little increase or something that we can control that.
Right.
Unless you just want to talk to them, there's no need to get them in here.
What did we decide? I know we talked a little bit about the other day, the biggest increase, it looked to me like the big one was elections.
Yes, but I've already pared that one back down. They put in $350,000 for what they call electronic poll books and or voting machines. And we're taking that back out. Anything like that, number one, we have to decide what we want, and it
right.
would have to be bid.
So that's gonna be backed out anyway?
On my side, when I'm doing that, I'm already backed out.
Okay.
What about Board of Supervisors?
I've backed that out too, and the amount that most of that increase there was for architect fees
right.
for what we're doing that. I put right. that down into the capital expenditures line because that will be part of a capital expenditure. expenditure when that, when that goes online, your architect fees are included, so I backed that out, put that down in there.
What have you got on there, vehicles with question marks?
Well, we have three new supervisors coming in. I don't know if they will want new vehicles, if they will want to take the vehicles that are out there.
That sounds like a wish.
What do y'all gonna want? You got two of them right here.
Darryl.
What do y'all want, new vehicles? You gonna be able to drive one of the old vehicles?
A brand new vehicle out of your budget? Won't you pay for it before?
You better watch out, that recorder's still going.
My suggestion is we don't put it in it, we let them decide.
I've got a great one that I turned in.
I just want Rodney to ruin that Crown Vic before.
That Crown Vic will fly.
I'm driving the same one, an '05 model that I got.
I got the one.
I'll put this way, the truck I'm driving right now is a 2000 model Chevy pickup with 292,000 miles on it, so.
Then you know how to make them laugh.
Well, there you go.
Well, see, he saw me driving the Crown Vic, and he said, man, I hadn't seen that car move like that ever. Because Wood was in it.
You got lights on?
Wood was in it.
It was the one Wood had. How fast do you think it went?
5 miles an hour.
Faster than it needed to sometimes. And I had Ken Martin's old truck, so I think it's got like 56,000 on it.
And I got Larry's.
Oh, is that right?
The Crown's a good ride.
I got a truck. So I'll swap
out.
He has air in his. But anyway, that was a request from Rusty. If he could have yours, that's something we'll discuss when everybody gets here. But so if y'all don't have any.
What do you mean when everybody gets here?
When we go come back to our next.
Talking about Walter and Jay.
Oh, okay.
Walter and Jay, and we went back to our next budget.
What do we do with Superintendent of Education? What do we do there?
I have started trimming that. I've got to talk to Rusty. He was had been talking to him there, like I told you, going with the state system, like we've gone
after
to
the election, it will be trimmed.
And it's supposed to pull it back in, and I've already started on my side trimming it.
I'm even speaking for my own blood.
What about this, as we always talk about, the Blue Cross Blue Shield?
That is hard to anticipate what we're going to spend, the amount that we pay, what the county puts in on the employees' behalf, and what we put in is never and never has been enough to fund it fully. So whether we go up on the county side and or the employee side, I don't know that we can go high enough to fund it. We don't have a plan. We're self-insured. So therefore, we pay the claims, and then we have our reinsurance where claims go high. We've had some really bad claims. We've had cancers. We've had a lot of things that have just, it's been a bad year.
We've had more lasers? We got more lasers?
I don't know. Our insurance does not renew. The date of renewal is January 1, so until in November, so we're not going to know if we have any more.
Okay.
We have one right now in the present.
And what?
Why does Chancery want $57,000? What's that for?
In Chancery Court?
Yeah.
That is the court reporter's raise.
Is that the?
That's a raise?
49. Well, not all of that. We didn't even have enough in there for the court reporters as it was.
Wasn't there a bill?
Yes.
The bill mandated.
Yes. House Bill 1049. Well, actually, it is at y'all's discretion. But it's over 3 years, and it is at your discretion. But the judges, one judge in circuit has done, they've done an order for theirs. Chancery has made a request.
Well, don't tell Walter somebody wrote an order, please.
I already told y'all that.
I hope Walter didn't hear it.
Okay.
He really gets upset with orders.
Well, I get upset when they come and do an order. Welcome to this side of the table.
Yeah. What
and then this is the last year for the hat raises, the judge's raises on House Bill 484. This is the final year on that one.
Lunacy court, zero. No change. Good.
Okay. And then we've got a county surveyor.
Yes, we had somebody running. We had one years ago. We did not have one this year.
What actually does the county serve? Do we, do they actually do anything? And who is it?
They are available for primarily for boundary line disputes, where you have to have a neutral third-party surveyor. Set out the statute, Greg.
And, yeah.
For health insurance.
Because they're an elected position.
Got one person, Mike Love.
And typically, that's what they run for is.
I was it.
That's an easy race, wasn't it?
I was it for a weekend.
24 hours.
Yeah, 24 hours. She puts my name in there as a surveyor.
Watching, I've already explained to you about the constables that are going up on this side. The money will come in on the receipt side because that's just a shift where it comes from. Basically, Ken McBroom told us about the sheriff's budgets and why, what they were doing there. He's also told me if I have to have more, that he'll come back in and help me trim if he can, that he comes sit down.
How does welfare administration have a $14,000 decrease in utilities?
What line item?
$450. No, $450.
That's just, I just looked at the trend of what's being used, you know, for their.
So they had money left over, maybe?
Yeah, and so I just trimmed it out where I can. Something that did come up the other day, though, to see if any of y'all remember this. When we moved the health department over to Pearl, you know, we renovated the building, moved them over there. Miss Whitehead called me the other day, and apparently the city of Pearl has called them and said nobody is paying a water bill. And so she called me and said, do y'all pay the water bill? And I said, no, we don't, and we never have. Not even when they were up here on Tamberlin. We didn't pay the water. We paid the power. The water, and they paid the telephone.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, y'all.
They is who paid the telephone, paid for the water.
The health department.
Okay.
Which is the state.
For their telephone, and always paid the water bill, and we paid the power.
Uh-huh.
And I said, y'all have always paid it. And she said, well, I believe that when y'all renovated this building and moved us in here, that there was an agreement that y'all would pay the water bill. I said, I don't remember that.
Yeah.
Nor am I aware of it. I said, if you can get any kind of MOU that we had with the state and give it to me that says we
I don't remember that.
That's because I don't remember that.
I don't remember that at all. No.
That was, wasn't that Jay's pet project?
Well, that was, yeah, we took some of the,
I think that was.
But I mean, so, that would have been, I would think, disclosed in the.
Yeah.
Any kind of.
Should have been.
I didn't hear anything about we were going to pick up the water.
Yeah.
But, so, because that was always paid for apparently by the state.
So we're waiting on them to come up with an MOU.
I'm waiting for them to produce a document.
Gotcha.
I mean, if we did, I'm not aware of it either.
Okay, I just thought I'd ask y'all something, but y'all remember if we had any kind of arrangement with that.
All right, and purchasing adjustments letterhead equipment, because we're moving her, right?
Yes, we will be moving, so she'll have to get new letterhead with address change and all that on it.
But that money and revamping the Justice Center, is that in here?
It's probably included in that capital project.
Okay.
Well, actually, it's on the it's in the miscellaneous fund section.
Did I get that one?
Yes, you did.
Miscellaneous.
Yes, the top it says miscellaneous. Okay. It is actually fund 350.
Oh, there's okay. There's another page. Cool.
That's a capital projects fund that has been out there that we've used for many years.
I got you.
To do various projects with. That's where the FEMA safe room that we paid initially till our money was reimbursed, till it came back in. We have about $235,000 left in that, and that renovation. With the basement renovation and the courthouse, we should be able to empty that fund, and it should take care of it.
We've been told.
Yes, sir.
Obviously, there's always the possibility that you could get into something you didn't anticipate.
Right.
But so far, that you guys, about the meeting that I recently had with our circuit judge and the DA, so far they have been very cooperative about the need this within reason.
Mm-hmm.
I think they understand and appreciate where we are financially. I don't think we'll be spending any significant money on that until into the next year.
Right.
We'll be beyond October 1 spending money on it. Now, possibly we'll spend some money on the purchasing area in the basement. I don't know, but we feel pretty good about the funds that are available in the capital project to be able to handle this. That's our goal.
So what do we do for, and I'm just asking questions. Hines Community College.
Yes, sir.
$3 million.
Yes, sir. We have a levy.
Levy.
There's a maintenance, OTEC, bond, fund. That's all their levies.
Revenue comes in, goes out.
And it goes out.
Okay.
Passes through us.
Pass through. Like grease through a goose.
They're just passing through us.
Yes. We also have the levies on for the volunteer fire district. We have 7 of them. Mm-hmm. That money comes in, it is turned right back around, it's paid back to them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You can see how this could be deceiving. I mean, not deceiving.
It is
hard to understand if you just picked it up. No, I didn't mean to use that word. I mean, if you pick it up, you won't understand. Some of this just passes through us.
Yes.
You know.
On this miscellaneous fund sheet, like if you see the Chaplain reappraisal and mapping, that is a 1 mil that we collect that we submit to the state each year. Mm-hmm. And they sign off on that we've done everything correctly. And then in October, we take the balance of the previous year and we shift it over into General County because that's where John has his mappers and appraisers and they're all paid out of General County. So we shift that money over that can be used for all their mapping and reappraisal needs. State drug money, that's controlled by the Sheriff's Department. The federal drug by the Sheriff's Department. The criminal special assessment, that's controlled by that.
But like the state drug money.
Yes.
Is that how we bought a robot? Or how he bought a robot?
Yes, part of it. Yes, sir. He bought it.
Correct.
Part of it out of his, yes. Mm-hmm.
There are limitations on what that money can be spent
right.
for.
Right.
Okay.
But most of the time, he can find something.
Right. And that's usually seizure funds that they get from stopping vehicles. That's seizure money that they get. Then 911 has no levy on that one. That is money that we get in through our 911 service fees,
mm-hmm.
radio charges that we charge out to different entities that we control the radios on, law library that comes in from fees and fines through justice court, through chancery court, circuit court. Our sanitation waste removal, we don't have any millage on that. That's generated by our users. And, you know, we went up last year on our amount that we're charging individual households. Looks like this year we're going to end in the black, as we anticipated.
Good, good.
Our fire does have a millage on it, 1.18 mils. The county is required to have at least a quarter mil obligated mm-hmm. toward fire departments, either in a separate levy or out of General County, and we have a separate levy on it, 1.18. Our Grand Gulf funds, that's money that we get each year from Grand Gulf that comes in because of our proximity to the nuclear plant site.
Really?
We get about $400,000 a year.
That's how we do our fire trucks.
We use that money for fire trucks.
Mm-hmm.
To
keep rotation of
the
fire.
Yeah.
That's to keep the road. That's right. Tobacco money that's been left for a long time. The Sheriff's Department, they're just using it as they need it. The inmate commissary fund. That money comes in for use of the inmate. It has to be spent on specifics. That's the money that is generated from the commissary fund that comes back in where the inmates buy stuff, and the money we get off of that has to be spent on specific things for them. I believe mattresses and different things.
Mm-hmm.
That
has to be a benefit.
Right. Dale's going to be here next Thursday to talk about his road and bridge.
His what?
Huh?
Talk about his what?
Road and bridge.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Then your 208, that's our bond fund. Then Pilahatchee Willahatchie Water Improvement Fund. That's a fund that we have on there that Willahatchie pays for. They pay us money back each year. We pay the principal and interest, and then they give us the money back. Those next few are empty. We talked about the 350 capital project fund that we go to use for the renovation of the circuit court. Then we have our self-funded health plan, which this money in here is the money that is generated from what the county puts in on behalf of an employee and what the employees put in. And it is not enough to fund it. Then the rest of them are going to be pass-throughs. Their millage, we collect, we turn around and pay it out to the entity.
Why did the public defender have a decrease in insurance, reduction in insurance?
It's just, nothing came off of theirs. It's just,
reduction.
Years ago, the public defenders, years ago, the county agreed, instead of giving them a raise, allow them to have medical insurance. Through whatever happened, several of them were allowed to have dental and vision and everything else, but a few years ago, we stopped that, and we said, if you want it, you pay for that portion of it yourself. And it's just been in that line item, and I'm just cleaning up some stuff.
Okay.
That's just been sitting out there.
Okay.
But they still do get the medical. The county pays, and if they have family coverage, they pay their portion.
On the data processing, he's down $38,000.
Yes, most of that's out of capital outlay. You know, over the past few years, his capital outlay was increased. He did some new things, get new control panels.
Are we still trying to fill a position in that department?
For the web manager?
Yeah. Yeah.
That wouldn't be in his department. That was going to come out of my department.
Well, he's saving 38. Why don't you put it in his department? He can go flush. I'm just kidding.
Well, right now we put the information out there for.
I know.
I think your colleague to the right may have something to say.
Not today.
No. But y'all aren't making any budget decisions today either.
That's right. This is just for you.
We had a good laugh earlier in the week.
Anything else?
No, just
where you're going to find trimming.
Well, she said she's already got that $10,000, so that's good.
Did y'all learn anything?
Sure.
Good.
If y'all are finished talking about budget stuff, I've got one item that Wilcox would like to discuss that we had discussed previously. So help me remember, I think we're going to have to add this to the agenda. If y'all want to take action, let me tell you quickly. Y'all recall that we talked briefly about dilapidated mobile homes.
Yeah.
And what to do about those.
Yep.
One of the areas where we have this situation is down in Robin Hood. These are abandoned mobile homes.
Right.
Attempts have been made to use the nuisance process to get them, to get attention to them.
Right.
And incentivize the owner to do something. That has failed. There's been no way to locate the owner of the property to get him to justice court. So you're left really with only one option if you can't do the nuisance property through justice court to be cleaned up. And that is for the county to clean it up itself and then assess the cost of the cleanup to the property and allow it to be collected as any other tax obligation. Eventually, you would hope to get your money back, but you know, if it is cheated to the state, you're not going to ever get that money back. It's just gone.
Right.
So I don't remember how the information came to our attention, but somebody who's in the scrap metal business approached somebody on our side and said it's probably something that can be done at no cost to the county if we can keep the scrap. If we can scrap the trailer, it's worth it to us going there and clean it up for you, so to speak. So y'all talked about it amongst yourselves. There was some skepticism about whether or not it could be done like that. We talked about
it. Oh, I can. I got a guy that will do it.
Yep.
Do it.
Well, the issue then became, what do we do about a situation? How do we make sure that we don't allow somebody just to go in there and chop it up and leave half of it laying around?
It's the insulation and
right.
the
It's the stuff that no one wants.
Right.
So the meeting of the minds needed to be that the vendor who's offering to go in there and scrap it understands they can't just go in there and chop up what they want, haul it out, and leave the lot.
Right.
Probably worse, or worse than what it is.
It'd be worse, yeah.
It was to begin with. So we just talked about putting together an RFP. Well, we've got an RFP now that we're prepared for you guys to consider. And what I'm suggesting is that if y'all are reminded to go ahead and put this out there to see what kind of response we get, the only cost that there would be associated with it at this point is just publishing the RFP.
Right.
You don't have to accept any bid that comes in. You can reject everything.
Are you talking about one person doing them all?
Well, actually, the process as proposed is for there to be one specific piece of property identified.
Okay.
And a location, and this would be our test case.
Okay. And then if we wanted to continue it on.
That's correct.
Then we can see if it's actually.
But I mean, would you do each individual case separately, just like that?
You can, but you don't have to. You can put multiple units on one RFP. But what my hope was that we would let this be a test case. Let's identify one tract. It's in Robin Hood because it's a unit that has been on the books for a long time.
Right.
Just pick that one site. There's a lot of people living around it. So I think Greg gets a lot of calls.
I do.
Are y'all going to do anything about this situation? So
right.
We can address a hot button issue in a populated area. We will essentially see how this process works with the vendor.
Right.
And if the vendor comes back, or if multiple vendors come back and say, we'll do it, but it's going to cost the county this, you guys can say, no, and reject everything and then reconsider another process. But if it comes back and somebody says, yeah, I'll do it at no cost to the county, then we can give them an opportunity to move forward.
The only problem is
it has to be that way because sometimes property's not worth what it costs to clean it up.
Right.
The other thing, though, aren't they, how are we, I know you got this covered, but I'm going to ask you, protect ourselves from any liability.
Yeah.
Once they say it, it's theirs, they're on their own. Is that right?
The requirements on the contractor is that they carry at least $1 million of CGL, commercial general liability coverage. That's in there. They have to produce a certificate of insurance at the time the contract's signed. There is an indemnification section in here that says that very thing, which would trigger their coverage.
Okay.
They have to have coverage on all of their vehicles as well that they're using. So if they're hauling stuff off and it's not on site when the activity occurs, if they're hauling stuff off and they run over somebody, that's their deal. And so there are other issues here too, anticipating some of your questions. They are being required, and a lot of this comes from work that Renee and I are doing together. And we actually interviewed one of the guys a few months ago who's in the scrapping business, and he was very helpful. He said, look, if y'all get in bed with one of these vendors, here are the things that you need to make sure is covered. So he gave us a lot of good ideas. Vendor commits that all roads or streets accessing the property will be kept free of soil, mud, or demolition debris. Following the demolition removal, the vendor will grade the cleared lot, and the vendor will stabilize the property with grass seed or sod, hay bales, straw mats, or other means of erosion control.
I'll be real surprised if you get anybody to do this.
Exactly.
Yeah,
that's why we're going to do a test case.
The scrap in that trailer is just the tin on the outside and the frame.
Right.
That's not very much.
And what we don't want, Jared, I think, is we don't want to go into a situation where in the vendor's mind, he's thinking, heck yeah, I just got access to a trailer that I can chop up and haul out of here in pickups. And tell everybody to see you.
Yeah. Oh, I agree with you. I'd be real to seed it, grade it, and seed it.
The problem being is once we do this, and I'm like you, I'm be real surprised we do find someone. Then the next problem is when the new three board members comes along, you're still gonna be.
Well, there's two of them right there. Y'all hearing?
You're still gonna be hearing the same. Do what now? You still got the same problems, except it's even bigger and bigger. It's just growing every day, because those manufactured homes are getting older and older and older, and people are leaving.
We're even going to make them.
I know where some are, the North End of District 2, that need to have the same thing done too.
Right, so there's, well, don't know what the problem is, right?
We got the same, I mean, this situation is everywhere.
Everywhere.
And there's even some that won't apply to this, but it's falling in houses.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I got about four in a neighborhood, and they all want them torn down, but they, you know, they belong to a bunch of heirs. One of them oversees property. Well, that's who gets the letter. Well, he ain't gonna pay the money to get torn down, and there, the others living all in wherever. They're not, I'm not putting any money in that, so. And he said, well, you're not getting me to do it, but the property's not worth.
And we've talked about control. We talked about control burns, but then all of a sudden you get DEQ.
They won't let you burn anything.
No, so you're kind of catching a big time catch 22.
Dumpster and haul them off.
Right. And at the county's expense.
Permits, all dumping permits are responsible. They can't bury anything on site. They can't burn anything. That's all covered in here.
Hey, that just reminded me, is it legal for somebody to be burying stumps and all on a site?
I think DEQ will allow organic material to be buried on site.
Somewhere, just the other day, I don't think where it was, I thought, I didn't know they'd let you do that.
Laws of decay, yeah.
Well, I sure hate to know one day I might have a house built over that hole.
The void.
It looked like a pond they were digging, then I saw them throwing all the stumps in there. I'm going to reroute my.
Well, if y'all are okay with that, I wouldn't mind going on a fishing. Because what is.
I don't mind.
Authorize us to put the RFP out for publication.
It'll shock me.
Let's just see what we got. We've got a fairly short turnaround on it. If we can get it published, we got a response date on this one as Friday, August 21. So it'll give them about 3 weeks or so.
Yeah.
Maybe one.
I think it's a great idea. I'm curious to see. I mean, to carry that amount.
At this point, we just don't know.
GL and stuff on your vehicle, man.
Right.
I bet it isn't $300 worth of scrap in that old trailer.
There may be someone out there that just.
You got a little bit of copper, but boy, you got to go through some stuff to get.
Yeah.
I
tell you what, the way they've gone through my garbage before, you never know.
I got online.
They're ripping wires on and just getting all that copper out of there.
I got online, looked around at other jurisdictions that do this. And the most recent one was about 6 months ago, and it was a similar situation, dilapidated trailers somewhere up in Tennessee, and they had listed a recommendation that was going before that particular government body, and they had listed out all the responses. And so you had about 15 vendors that were making bids to do cleanup, and about the cheapest reply was somewhere in the neighborhood of about $5,000 to remove a dilapidated trailer from a particular site. Mm-hmm. But what you got to remember is these sites are not going to be comparable necessarily. There'll be a site where it's really easy to get to, and it's close to the dump site, and the trailer is, maybe it's even movable. Well, you're going to get a bid back on that that's a lot less expensive than one that's been set up and is in six pieces, and it's way out.
Well, if we get them in there moving them, it needs to be a clause in there also. They can't give them to somebody for $300 to put up for and ask for a permit for it.
Right. Well,
that happens. Condemned trailer, and I know a guy that buys them. And he tried to put them up, and he used to try to put them up and have people living in them.
Just moving down the
couldn't
road.
Couldn't hardly make it down the road without pieces falling off of it.
Move it right down the road. Here we go.
So it goes from being a dilapidated trailer to one that is living there inspecting.
That's right, they're inspecting.
But the person's already bought it then and thinking they're going to move in it, and you go
to
say,
the scope of service here, it says destruction and removal. So while we don't want to get into the business of telling them exactly how to do what they do, I think we can make it clear that what we're talking about here is carving this trailer.
Right.
Up into pieces.
Because it's no longer inhabitable or whatever, yeah. So it's.
Yeah, we even make them, I mean, there's a lot of surprises in here, to be honest with you, but like I said, these were pieces of advice. We even make them empty, collapse, and fill in any abandoned septic system.
Good luck.
Man, these guys are going to go in the hole. That is a test case.
If he gets this through, I got some other stuff on him to sell for me.
Hey, but you don't know till you go fishing.
We've tried to keep an idea on every conceivable escape hatch that these guys would be looking for and sort of wall it off on the front end. And what we may find is that nobody wants to respond. But I think let's do a test case and see what we get.
Yeah.
Now, what I did once, we had a situation like you're talking about, and we took us out of the loop. I just gave the lady the number of a guy, and she could deal with him.
Yes, sir.
It took us completely out of it. And he tore it down. It was up to her. I mean, her to make sure he cleaned it up and whatever. But he tore it all down and got rid of it.
The problem being with us, though, was like he said on the front end, we can't find that person.
Right. Yeah, this situation, the lady, somebody.
This is like either the county do something to.
I know. I know. Same with these old houses. Yeah, I agree.
By doing this RP process, if we come back outrageous, then at least Greg's got something he can go to the people and say.
Yeah, well,
the cheapest we could get was $15,000.
Right.
Lot's not even worth $3,000.
Right.
Yeah, do you want
folks in probably paying? Isn't it about a quarter acre lot?
Yes.
Yeah, it's probably that small.
At least that small, yeah.
Yeah. That's what I thought, third acre. Yeah.
This way you're only out of the publication.
Right.
I don't know what to do about them, but I would love to clean those things up for them, but we can't be in that cleanup business. Old. But
yeah.
These three old houses, they're just falling in.
It won't ever stop, Jerry.
No.
When the municipality does that, like the city of Jackson goes in and clears out the dilapidated houses, where's that funding? Where are they? They just eat the cost?
Yes, sir. And municipalities, I'm glad you guys are in here because you'll hear this a lot.
Yeah. A lot.
Municipalities have three times as much authority to do things as counties do.
Right.
The law for municipalities is you can do it unless we tell you that you can't. That's the law for municipalities. Y'all can go right ahead and do everything unless there's a specific law that says you can't do it.
Do they put a lien on the property?
Sir?
Do they put a lien on the property?
Yes, sir, they do. Right. For counties, the law is you can't do it unless we tell you you can. It's completely flipped the other way. And so we start from the perspective, is there any authority anywhere that says that we can do this? And when we beg a lot of times for some sort of statutory authority to do stuff that we would like to do, and this would be the primary example, we cannot get on private property and expend any benefit of taxpayer funds where that benefit cannot be shown to benefit taxpayer general, the public general. Health, welfare, that kind of thing has to be established. And in these situations, it's hard to convince somebody in public that they need to help pay to get a trailer off a lot and run it.
Yep.
Sort of see the trick bag that we find ourselves in. And the problem is, obviously, and I hope you guys can sort of be thinking in these terms, so many times things come up and they make a lot of sense. It makes an awful lot of sense. The county ought to try to do something to help with that. But the calculation that has to go on up here is, if we do that for them, who else are we going to have to do that for? So when the school district shows up and says, we need y'all to put an ad in the Pisgah football deal, they have to think, good Lord, how many of those will we fit to pay for? Then you're going to pay for middle school, and you're going to pay for high school, you're going to pay for baseball, you're going to pay for football and soccer.
Cheerleaders.
I mean, just.
You're nonstop.
Junior high soccer, junior high cheerleaders.
Yeah, it gets nuts. And so you have to put things in place.
So is there a way that it could be
kind of, I mean, a little bit about what you say and kind of testing, but kind of like each district actually have some sort of a allocated fund or whatever to where Mr. Wilcox can spend $10,000 this year on dilapidated property.
That'd be wonderful. You know, unfortunately, we operate on what's called a unit system.
That's where it throws it in the ball. That's.
If it ain't benefiting all the counties, they ain't talking about it.
If it was a Yazoo County, you could do that, then you could build a new.
Yeah, you can't. We can't break it down into districts because we're not beat system. And it, you know, we've broached that before, and it's really, I mean, I've thought the same thing as you. You know, can you put a pile of money? But you just can't do that because it's not legal for us to do that because it's a unit system. It's all five districts, it's all their money. Right.
But all counties and state don't operate that.
No, that's right.
Jones. Majority of them are unit, but not all of them.
See, like Jones County where I'm from, they're beat system, so they still get to do, they got their pots of money.
Of course, got this big mess going on in the news. It's probably going to make national news with the supervisor that came and tried to take some of his equipment.
Right.
Sell it because he didn't want to approve.
Yeah.
It's, they got a fun thing going on up there.
Along the same line of what you just said there, is there not a way, like you said, the health and safety, you know, you got a dilapidated property down there, somebody can go down to Robin Hood and get hurt.
Right.
Well, not a way.
There's always the ability of the board in its discretion to make certain findings. They just have to make it on the record. But a finding that the unit there in Robin Hood is a public health, safety, and welfare problem, that finding, once it's made, and they've already done it. They've recognized that problem. We've had a nuisance hearing on this specific piece of property. They declared it a nuisance.
We just can't find the people.
There's just nobody for us to
go after.
For a court that could order somebody to go in there and remediate the problem. So it falls back on the county's lap. If it's going to get fixed, it's going to have to be done by the county. So what we're trying to do now is figure out what is the simplest, cheapest way to get that dilapidated trailer remediated and protect the county. And we're going to explore whether or not there's a vendor out there who's willing to accommodate that cost by taking the scrap.
I love the idea.
Well, that's the thing
about it. That'd be a loophole to get through to tear down any facility, any
right.
of these. These three houses I'm talking about, they are deplorable. I wouldn't want to walk in. I'm scared the floor would fall in. And they're terrible, but in the same situation, they're truly a hazard to the community. And you got some houses built close by. If this old house catches on fire, it's probably going to catch this one on fire. But, I mean, that's the loophole that would be used that everybody would just fall back on and say, I'm ignored. They'll let them declare it a junk hole and they'll have to tear it down, you know. So it's just, I don't know what the answer is, really don't.
If y'all are ready, Greg, just need to add this.
I make a motion we add this item to the agenda.
All right, motion to add this item to the agenda by Mr. Wilcox, second Mr. Keith. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Greg, the motion would be that we authorize the publication of an RFP for removal of a specific dilapidated trailer in Robin Hood. Mm-hmm. And authorize Renee to receive and review those responses and report back to the board at the end of August.
Okay.
I like that motion. So move.
All right. Motion by Mr. Wilcox.
Second
Mr. Keith. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
All right. I'll get with Renee and we'll get it published.
Okay.
See what we get. We'll keep y'all posted.
Great, thank you.
All right, any more business?
No, I just have a question for you, but I can ask you later.
Okay. Yeah, I have one too. I can ask you later too.
Okay. So do we need
to look at
so. Recess or adjourn?
Recess.
All right.
To the 30th.
Motion to recess.
I make a.
The 30th.
Make a motion. We recess to the 30th of July, 9:00.
All right. Motion to recess to the 30th. Mr. Wilcox, second Mr. Keith.
Yes.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. We've recessed.
Okay.
5 minutes before 12.